let me play the intro.
So you fail in your endings, you fail in your opening.
Yes, I'm failing in the intro too right now. All right, so we'll have a better intro for you guys in the future. But yes, right now that's our intro. New setup. Hey, got my man right here. Where you at? Fight. Give me half, oh, other side.
Yeah, no, it's the other hand. It's because I'm backwards for you.
Oh man, what we do? Oh, and then look, lag. We got Phil. Yeah, that's the lag, right? Professor Phil Bell down below. Give us the high five there, Mr. Bell, Dr. Bell.
There you go.
There you go. Okay. How are you doing tonight, sir?
Yeah. That was a nice Brady Bunch moment.
Yes, it was. Yes, it was. Let me pull this. Oh, God, man. We have such a good time doing what we do. Let's see. I'm trying to make sure that it looks like it's buffering a little bit on my end.
Yeah, we are live.
No, I guess.
The stream seems fine.
It does? Okay, well, maybe it's... If I showed you my screen, you'd be like, what is going on? Okay, so everybody, welcome to the show tonight. We have a very special guest on tonight. Let me go ahead and put myself full screen. God, dog it, this is acting weird on my end. Sorry, guys. Let me get that. My screen is flashing, so I want to make sure that it's not flashing on the actual live stream. Will you double-check that?
Fight the Flat Earth?
Okay, it does. All right, good.
Yeah, I haven't seen you flash.
Okay, well, on my screen, it's literally flashing every second, so.
He did wear a mankini, so.
Yeah, I might have broken the internet.
Yeah, it doesn't know what to expect.
All right, so, Professor, we're going to bring you on first. Why don't you tell us a little bit about yourself and tell us what you do.
Okay, well, I do two things. One is I'm an educator, so I teach physics. I started off as a chemist, as an analytical chemist, so back in the very early 70s, and then moved on to water science and then physics later on, and so now I'm concentrating on doing physics, and my specialty is in orbital mechanics. So that's what I teach mainly in. And as you can see from the board behind me, so I'll stand up and have a look. How's that? You can see that? There you go. We'll have a little lesson in orbital mechanics shortly. And I want to go through... to discuss the Chandrayaan lander, which went to the moon just recently. So.
Now, you worked directly on that project, correct?
Well, actually, I'm more of a problem solver, so I sort of come in at the end of it. I mean, I obviously know about the project and have been had something to do with it along the way, but really, this is the shark for me, because obviously something's happened. But generally speaking, we would be expecting things smoothly. We don't have troubles getting any lights, for instance, into orbit these days, whereas we did in the past. So, my involvement is mainly in troubleshooting area. In fact, I'll be heading to India on the 1st of December for about 3 weeks and we'll be meeting and discussing the possibilities.
Nice.
Awesome.
Well, we do have a few questions from the chat eventually to get to as well. But
sure.
I just want to talk to you a little bit about your YouTube channel because you're relatively new on YouTube. Is that correct?
Oh, yes. What happened was I started thinking that maybe this is a good way to get students who are too lazy to come to class to, so they can at least hear what I said. And it's been sporadic because, mostly they come because I threaten them. And then, but occasionally some don't, so then I'll post the lecture, So it's pretty sporadic. So if you go to, you'll see some lectures in, because I'm still teaching chemistry, so you can see some lectures in physics and chemistry as well. And then in between that, you know, I've watched a Flat Earth video and it's got me a bit triggered, so I've gone and said something about that. So my last one, I pretty much scolded them for life. And
do you enjoy the actual process of going in there and just destroying them? I mean, I enjoy it. It's fun to me. I mean, it is
kind of fun, but to be honest, it's a bit like shooting fish in a barrel, you know, even for you guys. So you know, the thing about it, what's asking is silly claims or just outright lies. You know, this is about if the boat goes over the curve, over the horizon, you can bring it back with a camera. I mean, that is, you can believe that, and then I'll say, well, you're mistaken. But come back and tell me you actually did the experiment and you saw that. Now I'm telling you, you're lying.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. Because if the boat goes, the hull goes, and then the mast goes, there's no camera that's bringing that back. Mm-hmm. And don't tell me it's perspective, because it didn't change angular size much as it was going down, you know, as it seemed to be sinking below the waves. Because if it was going away from you, then it would be getting smaller and smaller and smaller, wouldn't it?
Yeah.
But it doesn't do that. It just seems to sink.
Well, even geometrically speaking, let's say the Earth was flat for a second, and geometrically speaking, the distance between you and the boat that's gone out of your sight, right? If you lift up in elevation, for instance, you're going to be able to bring that boat back into sight. You know, just because you've gone up in elevation, geometrically speaking, it's going against everything you're saying, because you're actually adding distance between you and the object. Yes, so if the object has already gotten so small that it's gone out of your sight, like you can't see it anymore, then increasing in elevation has also increased the distance between you and the observed object. It should be even more smaller than it already is.
In fact, by a factor of root 2. Yes, exactly. Because this is the hypotenuse
now. You've got the occasions when you have the big tankers and you can quite clearly see that one of them is on the horizon and one of them is halfway over the horizon, and you can still see half of it, and it's big enough to see. So it's nothing to do with angular resolution at that point. There's a physical obstruction between you and the bottom of that ship. You know, the perspective and angular resolution isn't going to do anything, because there's no way you could ever zoom that boat that is halfway hidden back in. It's just ridiculous. Exactly.
So the idea is, so somebody comes on like this Davian, that you know, cloak tour, that's what triggered me, and saying that, hang on, you did this experiment, and you brought the thing. No, sorry, the only way you could do that is if you climbed up a hill. Then you would.
Yeah.
And then explain to me why, if you're in the helicopter, you see the sun go away, set, and then you get in a helicopter up and you see the sun again. How does it
not? Yeah, been there, done that.
Yeah.
I mean, how silly is that? You know,
You can do it in the Burj Khalifa in Dubai. You know, you can literally watch two or three sunsets as you go up the elevator. So there's no reason on flat Earth that increasing your elevation should make you see further.
Yes, I've actually done that very thing. I was invited to Dubai by a colleague, and we actually did that just for fun, you know. And it actually, getting right up there, you know, the sun almost beats you to it. You know, it goes down pretty quickly.
It's amazing.
Yeah, but I actually did that. So I thought I better scold some of the guys. I mean, my whole reason for doing this is to keep the, the ones who are sitting on the fence from falling into this cult, because it seems to me like they trap you and then it's almost impossible to get out.
Yeah, and I feel the same way. When I talk about what my involvement is and why I do it, I say it's for two reasons. Number one, there's people out there that know everything that I'm saying and something more. I mean, I'm definitely not the smartest person out here. So for those people, they're just here to laugh. You know, I'm just simply entertaining those people. There's a small percentage out there that just don't know. They don't know that science. They don't, even if they believe the Earth is not flat, they still don't know the science. They still don't know how to address the topics, and they still want to learn something. Yes. I do it for those people, so those people don't fall victim to believing something that they just don't know how to refute. And some of these can be pretty hard, like when people talk about the, you know, Rayleigh criterion, when they talk about refraction and refractive indexes. When they talk about these things, if you don't know what they're talking about, you may just believe them at face value, even when they're wrong.
But the thing is that they say these words and these phrases, but they don't actually know what it means. You know, you'll try and say, well, that's not right. And they go, yeah, but Rayleigh criteria says. But they've no idea what the Rayleigh criteria is. Or they've no idea what the actual law of angular perspective is. But they will constantly throw out these buzzwords and stuff that they've heard someone else say. So as far as they're concerned, that's proof. And how can you not know that, you stupid globetard?
Yeah, right.
Well, I hear this word a lot. Electromagnetism. And I hear that used so badly, you know, it makes me want to chew my arm off. so apparently this is one of the explanations for gravity, electromagnetism. Who knows how that they could ever get that electromagnetism?
There's actually something behind that. Well, at least in the flat Earth mind, because they say that Coulomb's law of electromagnetism is essentially the same as Newton's law of universal gravitation attraction. But the only thing they share is over R squared, like ratio. And apart from that, one describes a attractive force, one describes an attractive and repulsive force. And obviously with electromagnetism, it's going to be different depending on the material of the item, whereas gravity affects all mass indiscriminately.
Okay, I get your point there. That's actually quite good, because you see the universal equation for gravity, as you know, is the big G m1 m2 over r squared. Well,
yeah.
The one for electricity, for force, is K, which is the constant Q1 Q2 over the distance squared.
Yeah.
Yeah, there
and
is a.
It's because they share that over R squared, like ratio, that they say, oh, well, it's essentially the same thing. K is just G.
Yeah.
You know, that is the constant. But it doesn't make sense on a lot of levels, because you still need a distance to a center of something for Coulomb's law to work. You know, it's still kind of based around the physics of our globe for that equation to balance itself out.
Well, not only that, gravity is hardly any different to, 100 miles up than it is on. So that would be a square law would make that hugely different if the case.
What's it on the ISS? They have about 88% of Earth's gravity.
Yeah, exactly. Now this thing, just hang on a second. I've just got to turn the power on over here. There you go. I don't want to lose my. Okay, that's all good. Run the battery, it's okay now.
Awesome.
Yeah. No, exactly. So I have also seen this conception where there's no gravity because they're floating around. Well, that's patently wrong too.
They're under gravity just like us, but they're in the free fall, the same as they're on a parabolic flight.
Got this.
So,
get into the center of the all right, and I want to how Newton is doing this for you, Mr. Riley, if you're watching. I want to explain to you how Newton and Einstein complement each other.
Oh, and this please ball do, will put do on it. Full screen.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, because this is what this is one big argument I've had with Riley. Because obviously Riley says that Einstein and Newton describe different things, because he likes to use the phrase Einstein snapped the wand of Newton. But obviously we know that Newton, his law didn't describe things working by the speed of light. You know, it didn't really take that into account. Yeah. But Einstein just explained it better. So please tell Riley why he's wrong, because I always enjoy that.
Okay, all right. Well, let me come back to that, because I need the board. I don't want to wipe out all of that stuff. That's okay. Can we go through some of that stuff that's on the board behind me?
Yeah.
You okay with that?
Yeah.
Yeah. Let me address a new member that we have in our chat. You can go ahead and get ready for your presentation while I address this new member.
Yeah.
But we do have a new member. His name is Fantarang, and let's see, I think that he was harassing me about saying hello. I believe it was him. Hold on, let's see. Somebody was harassing me about saying, yes, it was him. He said, say hello to our Norwegian friends too, please. Fantarang, I wish I knew how to say hello in your native language, but I unfortunately don't. I'll learn by the next live show. And I'll be saying a proper hello to all my Norwegian friends. To all my Aussie friends out there. Aussie, Aussie, all day. Love you guys.
Oi, oi, oi.
Right. And Professor, I do want to point out that we do have a question for you. We'll get to it after we do the your presentation.
Okay.
But I don't want to forget this question, because it comes from the casual spaceman. So
that's all right.
Yeah, fight the flat Earth. If you'll be sure to remind me about that question, so I don't forget. Okay.
Okay, and please call me Phil. Okay.
Oh yes, sir, Phil.
All right, Phil.
Okay. All right. So up on the board, I don't know how much of this you can see. But anyway, I'll talk through it. Now, this over here is the Earth. So here. So this is let's say this is the Earth. So the flat people, just picture this as an Earth, as a sphere, okay? And then we have the moon over here. So basically what happens is the Chandrayaan is a mission to put a, well, first of all, the first one in on the 20, that went into lunar trajectory insertion, was on the 22nd of the 10th, 2008, and it did a hard lunar landing on the 14th of the 11th, 2008. And that's a nice way of saying that it crashed. But we actually expected it to crash. So that was no expectation that would be a soft landing. So we talk about a hard landing and we talk about a soft landing. So a hard landing means that that's the end of it all. Everything is splattered all over the place. So it's taken about 10 or 11 years to come up with, to now do this. You can see from 2008 to 2019, where we've now sent Chandrayaan 2. And so, but what's happened is, so this over here, you can see that, first of all, what happens, it leaves Earth and then does an orbit and does subsequent orbits. The orbit, the elliptical orbit, gets bigger and bigger and bigger, okay, in this trajectory, until finally it has enough momentum to be able to head to the moon. And once it gets to the moon, it then does again elliptical orbits until eventually it gets close enough where we make maneuvers to actually bring that, to do a soft landing on the moon. Now, in this particular case, the idea was to land on the south pole of the moon. Now, I don't know if your viewers know this, but the south pole of the moon is always dark. Okay, so it is very, very cold because it doesn't get sunlight. And one of the things that we just did discover from the first Chandrayaan was that there's water there. So we expect the water to be ice, but obviously this mission over here was to actually land there and then investigate what that water is like. Now, if you doubt it, every kilogram in space is $36,000. So water is an expensive commodity, and it would be really handy if you could get and harvest it on the moon, because that's the water gives you fuel to get back. So you, the water can break up into hydrogen and oxygen and give you the fuel that you need to, and the oxidizer that you need to get back. And obviously it's also useful for sustaining any existence on the moon if you plan to have a station. And at the moment there is a race among a few nations to put a station, permanent stations on the moon. This most definitely will happen. Okay, so what did happen? When it got within about 20 or so kilometers from the surface, the telemetry was lost, and then we got the telemetry. By then, that's only a few seconds, by the way. The thing's moving at about 50 meters per second, so you can realize that that would have been not much time before it landed. And because there wasn't, the telemetry was lost at that point, we didn't know what happened for a little while. Well, we knew, but confirmed that what happened. Now, there's lots of speculation about why it happened, and one of them is this. In the formation of the moon and the formation of the Earth, there was impacts, and certainly even since then, the craters, for instance, are a result of impacts. And sometimes the substance that hits the Earth actually stays there, gets buried, if you like, beneath the surface of the Earth and becomes part of it, either the Earth or the moon. Now, these things here, for instance, like magnetite, which is 72% iron, can actually change the gravitational force on the Earth at that point. So whereas around it can be quite different to that place where this stuff is embedded in the Earth or embedded in the moon. And that might have something to do with what happened. Of course, again, at this stage, it's just pure speculation. But it's interesting that to know that sometimes the gravity can vary because of these impacts, where the substance has actually stayed, become part of the terrain, if you like. So I've got a few formulas up here, and for those who are interested, you can have a look at this. We talk about orbits, and this is Kepler's law, so despite the fact that we've got Newton and Einstein's work up, Kepler's law is really the predominant law that's used for orbits. It describes them quickly. And you can see one of the things that we have to do in putting a satellite is decide what we want the satellite for and what's it supposed to do, for instance. If it's a stationary satellite, we want the satellite to remain in one spot all the time. That means it's got to travel it has to orbit at the same rate that the Earth spins. Now, this is actually, by this ratio, the cube of the radius divided by the period, in other words, the time that it takes to go around once squared, is actually the ratio. So whatever you want the satellite to do, how fast you want it to get around, that is the distance that you put the satellite away from Earth. So a geostationary satellite would be 36,000 kilometres away, and at that distance, it would then take 24 hours. It would follow the Earth in 24 hours and appear to be stationary in the sky. Others, like polar satellites, for instance, go north to south. And the purpose for that is because we want to see every square inch of the Earth. So how does that happen? As this satellite is going around north to south, just off about 5 degrees, north to south, the Earth is spinning beneath it. Now, So as the Earth is spinning, the satellite is going around this way and taking the photographs and doing its observations that it needs to do. It takes about 12 hours to cover the entire planet. So this is not proof that the Earth spins, I don't know what is. Okay, if you're interested, have a look at the rest of that. Now have a look at this. We've got
Professor Bell, may I ask you a question? Can I ask you a question? Would you say that the satellites remain relative to the distant stars and the Earth spins underneath the satellites, and that's why it takes 12 hours, because if it remains fixed to the rotation of the stars, or fixed relative to the stars, then it would take 12 hours for the Earth to rotate under it to cover half the Earth. And you'd be covering half going over one way and then half going over the other way. So it would only take 12 hours to cover the entire Earth for that reason. Is that correct?
Yes, that's absolutely correct. Yes. Yeah, just 12 hours. So having a look at this, you can see F equals mass times acceleration. And acceleration, obviously, is G. So 9.81 meters per second squared is G. And over here, we've got, so F is equal to mg. So in other words, your weight. So weight is your mass times the gravitational acceleration. And when I wipe this off eventually, and then we start talking about the intersection between Newton and Einstein, you'll know how important that this is. So you can see that force is also the mass, because the gravity is the velocity squared over the radius. So force is mass times velocity squared over a. So all I've done is I've replaced from F equals mg, I've taken the g out and put mv squared on r. And that, of course, because its force is also equal to g m1 m2 over r squared. So it's very easy to work out the velocity of an object. So when we see the velocity of an object and we see how far it's moving, we can determine its distance, because I can rewrite this formula to give me r. So it is not surprising that I can work out the distance to the sun, or any planet for that matter. Okay, that's how it's done, flatties. All right, let's have a look at... just a bit of interest. I wrote this down over here. The Chandrayaan 2 came in a number of stages. So it's a GSLV Mark 4 rocket, three-stage rocket, with the S-200 strap-ons. So it's got a central engine, S-200 engine strapped around it. It's an extremely powerful rocket. It's got the L110 liquid, so UDMH and four oxygens. I can see I've lost the words now. And then also C25 liquid as well. Okay, so that's in the third stage. And the third stage is obviously what take it to the moon, right? I was going to say it's dinitrogen pentoxide, but that's 5. So it's actually tetroxide. That's it, dinitrogen tetroxide. Okay, I'm getting a bit old. Okay, all right. So, oh, by the way, that stuff, the magnetite that crashes into that creates this anomaly for gravitation is Fe304. And generally speaking, so iron oxide would be Fe203. But this is extremely high in iron and therefore very susceptible to being magnetized at 72% iron. So I think I've covered all the things that I've written on this board, so I'll be happy to wipe it off and we can discuss Newton and Einstein. So,
yeah.
Any questions?
Yeah, absolutely.
I am
bringing on the casual spaceman who he's got a channel and he talks a lot about NASA and the works in space that we're doing. And he would like to ask you some questions, if that's okay, when he gets here. So he'll be here now, soon, but carry on.
I have a question as well. So when you were discussing why the satellite crashed into the moon, were talking about the possibility of having gravitational fluctuations. Would that be similar to the geoids, the geoid structure of the Earth, where we have different parts of the Earth that are, let's say, that where the land is a little bit more compact than in other parts, and that results in a slightly higher gravitational pull, and that's something the satellite wasn't prepared to account for?
Yes, for mostly on Earth, it's except over Australia, by the way, which is the Kimberleys, where most of that part of Australia is actually has the magnetite. In general, very very small fluctuations in gravity around the Earth, but in some satellites like the moon, there could be some quite significant anomalies because of those kind of impacts.
Hey, casual.
And they weren't taken into account, could certainly have effect on landing a spacecraft.
Yeah, now I believe, excuse me, Casual Spaceman has joined. How are you doing tonight, sir?
Oh, I'm doing good. Can you hear me?
Okay. Yes, we can hear you, bud.
Yeah, I may need to send a link on my end, Fight, so that way there's not a huge delay, because there'll be a delay between me and you and then you and him. So give me 1 second. I'm going to send you a new join link.
Oh, okay.
Casual Spaceman, I'm going to send Fight the Flat Earth another join link. Just join on this link, and we'll bring you in on my connection instead of his. Give me 1 second.
Yeah, I'm a few seconds behind.
Yeah, no problem. Okay, well, I'll just close this one down then.
Yeah, just close that one down. I'll send you a new one.
There you go.
Okay. That's all good. Yeah, no problem.
Okay, and while we get Casual Spaceman in, I'll go ahead and read the super chats that have come in while we were talking. Demonic Davro says, Aussie, Aussie, Aussie! And I say, oi, oi, oi! All right, and then we have Justin Neal says, thank you for shows like this. Hey, it's my pleasure. I love doing shows like this. I'm going to tell you right now, stick around to the end, but because we have a big announcement for our next scheduled interview. You're going
for
to
Wednesday
love this,
show,
guys.
Yeah.
You're going to love this, okay? So just stick around. We'll talk to you about a couple of upcoming shows that are coming on that you guys are going to like. James Collins for $1.99 says, I am loving this. Yeah, me too. Anytime I get a chance to speak on an actual intellectual level with somebody, it just gets me all giddy inside.
I love being around people that are smarter than me. I mean, that's most of the time, to be fair, but, you know.
God's Auditor for $2 said, just won $500 in the lottery. Enjoy. Thank you, God's Auditor. Whoop, whoop. I appreciate it. Congratulations to you, man. And then we have, let's see.
Yeah.
Earth is Seriously Flat says, ask the globe zombie how to verify the vacuum of space. I'll get to that one, Earth is Seriously Flat. I will, actually. And then
I'm happy to discuss that vacuum of space thing, if you like.
Yeah, let me do the last super chat, and then we'll let you take over from that.
Sure.
Supreme Leader Steve for $2 says, can Unirock explain what Bell said? You know, I'm not sure that he could, but there's probably 90% of the people on Earth can't explain what he just said. So I don't think that's really like a bad thing. I think that you guys just got a pretty badass free science lesson, though. And also, we have a new member, Cajun Drifter. And also, we forgot to do this for our first member, Fantarang, but you guys know what to do. Professor Phil Bell, how much of our live streams do you watch? Do you know about the member, the order the member emojis go in?
No idea.
Good deal. Okay, so we're about to teach you real quick, okay? Every time we get a new member, all right, the very first emoji we do is we show them our dinger. That's nothing sexual. Okay. It's simply our dinger. Take it for face value. So after the dinger, we have two options, okay? We have the option of meat tube, and we have the option of mankini. Now, Fight the Flat Earth and Shawn Hufford have a serious problem. They're both very intelligent people. However, they have a very serious problem in following directions, okay? So I'm going to go ahead and ask you, which one would you like to see second? We'll give you a chance to answer the right one. Would you like to see the Mankini next, or do you want me to whip out that meat tube?
You had a dinger there, didn't you?
Yeah, the dinger's already been out there. The people are doing the dinger.
That goes very well with my surname, so dinger sounds good to me.
Wise right, choice. So,
what comes after the dinger, though? Is it the meat tube or the
meat tube? Actually, that was a nickname I had at school, come to think of it.
I think Casual's logged back in now, team.
All right, so the second one, for those that don't know, is the meat tube. And the third one we show off, we get halfway naked in our Mankini. Now, Casual Spaceman has
scare children
arrived.
At Halloween.
Casual Spaceman has arrived. Let me go ahead. There's a couple of new Super Chats came in, so let me just read these out real quick. He says, Supreme Leader Steve says, have Unibrock explain 9/11 Back to the Future theory. I've seen that. It's pretty crazy. I'll be honest with you. Of course, I do believe it's all coincidental, but very, very highly coincidental things. And then Earth is Seriously Flat says, it's a rescue mission to end the globe zombie mind. Okay, so let's go back to what he said, and you said you were going to the question of how to verify the vacuum of space. Take it away.
Yes, okay, let's get on with that little bit. Okay, so here we go. First of all, let's talk about something. Let's talk about, put this in perspective, okay? So let's say, for instance, this little ball over here was the Earth. Well, the amount of atmosphere above this would just be a few molecules high. It would be less than for instance, a very, very thin piece of paper would surround that. That would be the distance, if you like, for the atmosphere. So we're talking about something that's very, 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 very small. Okay, so I'm just going to depict that, and obviously it's not to scale for that very reason I just described. So here we go. Let's say that's the surface of the Earth. Okay, and we're talking about the atmosphere. At this point over here, right near the surface, at 101 kilopascals, 0.3 kilopascals. That's the pressure. Now, PV equals nRT. This is the universal gas law. This is the ideal gas law. Pressure, volume, the amount of moles. Moles means the amount of grams. A particular amount of grams makes a mole, and then a constant and temperature. So all of these are related to how much there is. So if I said I want to know how much there is, it's N equals PVRT. Now, the reason I've described that is down here at the surface of the Earth, that's where most of it is. Now, as you get higher and higher and higher, you get less and less moles. In other words, the concentration of each gas gets less and less as you go higher and higher. And by the time you get to around about 100 kilometers, there's practically none, practically no, very, very few molecules per cubic meter. In this case, this is actually per liter. So this PV equals nRT. Volume is described as the amount in a liter. So in terms of volume, at normal temperature, you would have 24.45 moles of the gas, 24.45 liters, if you like, for every mole of gas, okay? By the time you get right up there, away, you get very, very few moles of gas in a liter of in a liter of volume. So the gradient goes from a lot smaller and smaller and smaller until there's practically nothing. Now, I've heard the flat earth people say things like, well, how can you have pressure, one pressure next to less pressure? And it doesn't equal life. Well, the reason it doesn't because of gravity. Now, is evidence to show that it doesn't equalize? Yes. If you begin your journey at the bottom of Mount Everest, you can breathe. If you get right to the top of Mount Everest, you can't breathe. You've got to be asking yourself, why is it? Why is it that you can't breathe at the top of Mount Everest? Or why is it need an aeroplane has to have a compressed cabin? Why do we need the oxygen in the cabin? Why can't an aeroplane fly beyond a certain height? That is because there is no oxygen at that height. Okay? In fact, the concentration of all the gases gets less and less as you go up. At some point, there's so little of it. The difference between little and very little is practically nothing. The difference between 101 kilopascals down here at the Earth's surface and over there where there's practically nothing is very, very small. 101 kilopascals is not a lot of pressure. So there's not a lot of differentiation, if you like, between space and the Earth. Now, do we lose some of the atmosphere to space? Of course. It happens. But luckily, we have chemical reactions on Earth that create these gases as well. For instance, respiration of plants creates the carbon dioxide, the oxygen that we need. Humans, you breathe out, you breathe in that oxygen and you produce carbon dioxide. You eat baked beans and you produce all the other gases as well. Gases of the that we produce on Earth by chemical reactions between various molecules that we have on the Earth already. So we are the atmosphere, and some of it is being lost. Hopefully, we don't lose as much as we create. This is a balance actually between what we lose and what we create. But I think time we might end up with like Mars, but there probably won't be to worry about by then anyway.
No. Okay, the flat earther that debated me called Harold, and the flat earther Harold was worried about the atmosphere escaping through the holes in the ozone layer.
Gosh. Well, okay. I can't even imagine what to make of that, but yes. We actually have a huge hole in the ozone layer right above Australia, so it's a wonder that.
Ooh, he froze.
Oh,
here we have the highest of skin cancer in the world because of the ozone layer.
Yeah.
So the whole point of that was that we don't need a barrier. We don't need a barrier between space and Earth's atmosphere. Gravity can holds down the molecules, just as it does hold down the water in the sea. Now, if you want to say, well, gravity is what gravity is, that doesn't actually matter whether we know what gravity is or not. What matters is we know what it does. And it does keep things down. Yeah. If I drop my pen, it will fall to the ground because it has mass. Every single molecule of gas has mass. So a mole of oxygen of ozone is 32 grams. A mole of carbon dioxide is 44 grams. So clearly the carbon dioxide is more dense than the oxygen. Okay? Now, if this gradient didn't happen, we would all be suffocating by now. We don't suffocate because the gases actually intersperse with each other. Otherwise, if, let's say, Mr. Riley's relative density thing actually was true, then all the carbon dioxide, which is 44 grams per mole, would be on the ground. You would have to stand on your tippy toes to breathe.
Yeah, so there'd be quite a layer of carbon dioxide.
Okay, so we don't stand on our tippy toes to breathe. That's because the oxygen and the carbon dioxide mix with each other. Okay, there is no relative density tower, if you like, with respect to the gases.
Well, now, that actually leads to one of Anthony Riley's internal contradictions with his relative density thing, because he says that the sun mixes up all the gases. Well, that would remove the whole density tower effect if it was all mixed up anyway, which leads us back to our gradient, which he doesn't account for.
Yeah, but he also says that the sun is at least 7 times less dense than us, sits on top of the atmosphere and mixes it up. What kind of, it's like having a ping pong ball in a lake and that mixing up the lake. It just wouldn't work, Riley.
Well, why doesn't it fall?
Oh, because it's less dense than the air, apparently.
With all that energy.
Yeah, yeah. Can you feel the stupid, Professor? This is what we have to deal with. So we have the casual spaceman with us. Welcome to the channel, okay. Casual spaceman. You have some questions for the Professor?
Oh, wow. Well, thank you. Well, first of all, we've got a few thank yous as well. Thanks very much for having me on. And I think also thank you very much to Professor Phil. I'm on the screen now. That's horrible.
Yeah, I figured I'd sneak you in, bring you in real slick and sly there.
Oh, yeah, that was a bit unexpected. Yeah, not only I was totally unprepared for this. I just saw in the notifications and then I saw the professor's name in the title and I thought, well, I've got to come on and speak. And I wasn't expecting to be coming on, so I'm totally unprepared. So I do apologise if I'm a bit...
You probably have better technical detail than I will, but go ahead. What would you like to know?
Yeah, well, my interest mostly is in Chandrayaan 2. I actually remember streaming that particular attempt. It was incredibly disappointing that it didn't quite succeed. I was quite surprised earlier on. You mentioned earlier on. You said that you weren't expecting a soft landing. Was that? Did you say that, or was that the wrong way? Did I see you?
Soft landing for the first one, Chandrayaan 1.
Oh, Chandrayaan 1, right. Yeah, okay, no problem. Well,
we most certainly were expecting a soft landing for Chandrayaan 2.
Well, that's why I was kind of surprised when I thought I heard you, but I misheard you, so I do apologise. Thanks very much. Well, it leads on to my question, then, really, is what do you think actually went wrong with Chandrayaan 2?
Well, there's two things, and that's left. So one of the things that we're getting data, you can appreciate, we make decisions and we make conclusions based on data. And if the data is not coming to us, then any conclusions we make is simply speculating.
Yeah. I remember just shortly before it was meant to actually land, they did lose the telemetry data, I understand. Is that correct?
Yes, that's correct. Yeah. So at that point, I'm pretty sure the data was lost. It was only about 2 kilometers off the surface when the data was lost. So at that point, traveling 50 meters per second, you realize that within a few seconds it would be on the ground. However, because the telemetry was lost, we didn't have the data from there. Although we do have other things, other bits and pieces of data which we try to find together and try and work out to come to a conclusion. It's a difficult thing to do, and there's so many variables and so many things that can go wrong. And unfortunately, they did. So 11 years of worth of work, by the way. And input from many different places, including some universities and around the world, including NASA, by the way. They had their had a bit to do with that. But, you know, people seem to think that these space agencies share, you know, I'll teach you how to do this, I'll teach you how to do that. It doesn't actually work like that. Mostly we're doing stuff from scratch every time. We have our own.
Yeah, absolutely. So do you think really that the main cause of that is because they lost the telemetry, they weren't able to actually control the spacecraft?
Exactly. If you don't know what's coming to you, you can't make decisions about what burns to make.
Absolutely.
I was reading that Tejantra 3 might actually skip the moon and go further into the solar system. Is that true, or are they still aiming to go to the moon?
We're planning on a human next time.
Really?
Wow. Okay.
Wow.
For Tejantra 3.
Actually, that was 2000. I remember putting human space like that, sending them to the moon is very, very risky business. It was a pretty sad day to lose the Chandrayaan 2, but we made it 3 years on it.
Yeah. For the benefit of maybe the audience, can you maybe explain what your role was within Chandrayaan 2 and what you actually did and all the rest of it?
I'm just one of those problem solvers. So looking at what happened and trying to work out what it is. So I'm not actually involved in putting the thing. I know quite a lot about it, but I'm working on the team that put it up in there. Yeah.
No. Before we get to a break and cover a few super chats, I have a question for you as far as if they plan on manning the next mission, which I could understand that them pushing that forward. Do you think that your team has figured out how to correct the problem with Chandra? Chandrasa, is that, did I say it right?
Chandrayaan.
Chandrayaan. I just want to say it right. Chandrayaan.
I think
Chandrayaan. I'm just going to say Chandrayaan. I hope I'm saying it right. I'm sorry.
If you have a pilot, mm-hmm. it's easy. That can make a decision.
I understand now. I understand. Yeah.
Yeah.
Putting eyes into the spacecraft gives them more of a hands-on experience for when something like
eyes, brains, all of that. Decision-making capabilities and a proper pilot who can sense and see what the problem is and then adjust for that problem immediately.
Do you think we could petition to add a flat earther to the cockpit?
Maybe just strap them to the nose cone of the rocket.
Just send me up. No, don't worry about a flat earther. Just send me up. I'll report back. Don't worry.
Right.
Okay, me too.
Let me get to the super chats real quick. Give me 1 second. All right. So we have the Bold Skeptic. The Bold Skeptic for €5. They should teach Flat Earth at school to mock it and teach the correct method by comparison would make it easier to involve the uninterested students. I agree. We also have Rampant with 1,000 claps. I believe those are Polish. I think you said it was. If the sun mixes the gases, wouldn't we die at night?
A little bit, yeah.
Good question. And then we have Justin Neal. Oh, Justin Neal is a new member. So, guys, you know what we do for our new members? Let's go ahead and do it. All right, Professor Bell, let's see. Let's see how good your information retention is tonight. All right, we start out with the dingers. Is that correct or incorrect, Mr. Bell?
I think that's what you said first, yes.
Yes, sir, that's right. And now do we go meat tube or mankini? I'm going to let Fight the Flat Earth answer, and you're going to grade him as pass or fail. Fight the Flat Earth, okay. Meat tube or mankini?
Go ahead.
Fight the Flat Earth, are you there? Let me make sure I didn't mute
him. Did he mute himself?
Yeah, no, sorry, I'm here. God. I was letting my cat out.
apparently you have to put a mankini on.
Oh, yes, no. You got it wrong. It's meat tube. All right. But it's okay, though, Professor Bell, Phil. Shawn Hufford doesn't get it either, so you're in good company tonight. All right.
Maybe it's just me.
You're talking about gravity, right?
Yeah.
All right, yeah, let me put you full screen, because this is something good right here. This, if you're about to explain it the way I think you're about to explain it, this is a really good representation, or this is a really good way of understanding gravity and what it really, really is. While you get ready, Phil, I'm going to go ahead and read two more Super Chats that came in.
No worries.
We have Earth is Seriously Flat for $2. Lunatics believe Masonic astronauts doing moonwalk. Well, I believe they did the moonwalk. But I also believe Michael Jackson did a moonwalk too, though. And then $10.
Yeah.
And then $10 from, God, I say this wrong every time. Sigifrido Sarabia. Want to ask Guy if three objects in free fall violate force equals mass times acceleration because they accelerate towards each other, and satellites should be inertial and not in free fall because inertial frames now fall relative to each other. Do you understand the question there, Phil? It's going to be kind of explained here, I think.
Let's just go through this and then come up with the question. Yeah.
Okay, give me 1 second. I'll put you up full screen so everybody can see you. All right, go ahead.
All right, so have a look at this board, and I've got a grid going over here. Across the one axis, if you like, of this. So this is a two-dimensional representation, okay? This is a two-dimensional representation of a four-dimensional concept. So time going across, if you like, this way, and position going down here. Now, this position one, that's really important that we think about that, because this itself is three dimensions. So when we take position, let's say, for instance, if you can see my pen, I'm holding the pen somewhere in space. So it's got three dimensions. It's in order to pinpoint where this thing is, it's got at least three dimensions. Now, that's three dimensions as we can think about it. But it's actually got four dimensions, because they're time as well. So time is an important factor about where this is, particularly if it's moving. And of course, because everything is moving, therefore time is an important factor in determining something's position. All right, so having a look at this grid over here, we've got time going across and position going down. So position, this one here, is taken up by, if you like, the three dimensions, x, y, so it's X, Y, and Z, okay? So these, or Z for the people in England. So X, Y, and Z are the three dimensions. That is represented in this one axis, okay? So this one axis means all three of these, okay? Now, let's say, for instance, you're in time and you're not moving. You're somewhere in space there, you're not moving. So this thing here is apparently not moving, with respect to me, because I'm holding it still. However, it is moving because the Earth is moving. So A, it's rotating with the Earth, and B, it's moving around the Sun as well. So this pen is going around the Sun. This pen is also going around, rotating with the Earth. So it is moving. I just don't see it moving from my frame of reference. Now, if something is absolutely not moving, then time is still going to go. So it's over here, time is still moving along, even though this thing is not falling. Now, let's say, for instance, it does move. Now, as this moves, time continues to move. So it forms curve. The reason for the curve is because as it's falling through position, time is also moving along. So therefore, it must move this curve. Now, the interesting thing is that when we talk about energy and we talk about the way things work on Earth, if I drop this pen, it falls straight to the ground. It doesn't go in a bend around that way. The reason that it goes straight to the ground is because it is going to expend the least amount of energy there. So in other words, it's going straight from here, straight to the ground. Okay, that is the most efficient way for it to go. Now, this curve is actually a straight line down. The reason that it is curved, the reason that space-time is curved is because time is part of the deal. So this curve over here is recognized everywhere. Recognized as if we completed this, we would have an ellipse. This is what this curve is shaped like. Now, let's have a look at a question. Why is it that two things, actually, before I get onto that, let's talk about why this happens and this idea of gravity being a force. Let's deal with that. Gravity is a force as long as there is something here to fall. In other words, needs mg. It needs both. Gravity does.
Can you just say that again, very clearly for Anthony Riley? Can you just say very clearly for okay. Anthony Riley, gravity is a force?
Gravity is a force as soon as you introduce mass.
There you go, Riley.
Mass is part of the deal. Okay, so mass creates this distortion in space-time, as you can see here. As you fall, time is moving ahead. So this causes this distortion in space-time. Now, this ball, I'm not sure if you can see that over here, but I've drawn some lines on this ball. Remember I spoke about what energy wants to do. So energy wants the most efficient way to do things. So energy will do the most efficient thing. So if we are going around a ball like this, not at the equator, then we're going to get a force, centripetal force. We're going to get a force because this is not a straight line. Okay? If it's going here, anywhere else other than through the center, around the equator, either north to south or around the equator, it is not a straight line. So it is not the most efficient thing. Now, if it's going around the equator, that is a straight line. Now, the question is, why do two things fall at the same time, regardless of their mass? Well, if you start in space-time, so imagine I've now taken this, turned it inside out, so I've now my representation is now this ball. So it was this two-dimensional, I've now turned it into a three-dimensional view of it. So if you can see, it's sort of inside out, so I've now looked at this ball. If I have a look at any two positions on this, so I'll put one mass here and one mass here. And they're going to fall through space-time like this. Well, remember what I said about the need for it to be a straight line. If you run a straight line, this one, and you run this one as a straight line, guess where they meet? Right there in the center. this is the fundamental explanation for why two things fall at the same time. If you want to look at that in terms of general relativity. So, from here, two fingers on the ball, straight line, they will both end up in one place. The same time. Okay, so that's it in a nutshell for how that works. Now, let's have a look at the intersection between Einstein and Newton. Now, yeah, I don't want to put up all
in the flat Earth.
Yeah, okay. I don't want to put up all the field equations, but I'm going to give you something very, very simple. Okay? First of all, we know that momentum is equal to the mass times the volume. Right? That's just common knowledge. How do the police know how... Yeah. How do the police work out how fast you were going at a crash, after the crash? Well, they can work out what your momentum is. They look at your mass. They can work out what the velocity is. So P equals MV. Okay, so V, when we're talking about light, is equal to this, which is the speed of light. Okay, speed of light. That's what C is. So if we say that P equals MC, okay, so in other words, because V and C are the same thing when we're talking about light. Now, energy is equal to momentum times the speed of light. So if I substitute both of those in, I'm going to get E equals MC squared. Newton, Einstein. That's a simple way of looking at it.
I'm just going to click that and play it for Riley over
that
and over.
That is beautiful. I've never thought of explaining it like that, and that is absolutely beautiful, Phil.
It's so simple. It's almost elegant.
I've got to state here right now. A lot of people that know me know that I am really terrible at maths, and even I can understand that. That's amazing.
Yes. Okay. All right.
Hey, skeptic.
Yeah.
Look at your VMix call.
All right. So if I went into all of the field equations, then we'd probably, lose everybody because that is fairly involved in a maths. But that is a very an elegant, simple way to look at how momentum and energy are absolutely related. And there's no question that Newton complements Einstein and vice versa. Right? There is no Newton. Amazing. Einstein broke the stick. All Einstein did was tell us what gravity is and how that works. Now, just on another thing, let's talk about gravitates. So Einstein postulated gravitational waves. So he said, because when we're talking about the bending of space-time, you've got to be asking yourself that, yes, I can understand how time will move across and an object falling will then bend the space-time. But what exactly is the space-time? And the answer is in the gravitational waves. So, if we think about gravitational waves as being a packets like this, we look at that and we say, what else do we know to be packets like this? Well, photons are. So it's not surprising that these things are related to each other. Photons related to, so visible light all the way from radio, all the way to gamma rays. And now we're talking about gravitational waves. Why are we surprised? Of course it's not surprising. Again, it's an elegant fit. So now we're talking about the gravitational waves. We have magnetic waves. We have gravitational waves. We have electromagnetics. It's not surprising that things are similar. Let's have a look at this where we've got gravitational. F equals gm1 m2 over r squared. Everybody's seen this? Okay, well, it's not surprising that F equals, for electricity, K, Q1, charge, Q2, over the distance squared. How is that not related to each other? It's elegant. It's the physics of it works because it's of its elegance. It should not surprise us that this works like it does. Gravitational waves have been discovered at LIGO. Lots more work needs to be done with that. There's nothing wrong having lots more work to do, thankfully, because we want people to have work to do. We have lots of stuff to discover. We want to know more about these gravitational waves and how they affect things, but there's no argument about how they work, about what they do, and how we can use it and how we can predict things using this. By the way, this will take us to where Newton couldn't take us, and that's at the quantum level. So even Einstein and Newton couldn't take us there. This is where we're going to get there with these gravitational waves.
It's exciting.
So in a nutshell, there's gravity. Okay.
Wow. Standing ovation. I'll read that super chat out, team. So James Collins from 199 says, Professor Bell explains this so well. Bravo, Zulu. Yeah, that was amazing. And I'm definitely going to clip that and use it in my debates. Thank you.
You're very welcome.
All right.
Can I just ask a question of you, Professor, if I may?
Go ahead.
Yeah, go ahead.
We recently measured, or somebody actually recently measured a gravitational wave and detected it. Can you tell us a little bit more about that, please?
Yes, this was done at LIGO. So again, going into the mathematics of it will be really, really cumbersome. But suffice to say that we have managed to detect something other than what's expected from the motion of particles. So this gravitational is an explanation for that. And its properties are pretty much on the same lines that we know about photons. So this detection, so it was ruled to conclude that this is the gravitational waves that we're looking for. Beyond that, I still have a lot of work to do myself in learning about it, and obviously so do the people who discovered it.
Yeah, let me read out this other super chat real quick. Earth is seriously flat, says, how to verify light years ago, which I guess he's trying to ask, how do you verify that something was the way it was light years ago? And to answer that,
it's excellent simply, question.
Go ahead.
Okay, all right. That's an excellent question. Okay. I'll look my board. All right. Okay, first of all,
Cats has got contender for best use of a whiteboard.
Yeah, let's talk about electromagnetism. So first of all, electromagnetism, if you like, electromagnetic waves are all the same. In other words, same stuff. They just expressed differently. Let's have a look at it. Radio down to here, visible light, X-rays, gamma rays. These are wavelengths. They get kilometers apart. So radio happens at, so flat people, how come, you know, you can hear radio from to Australia, for instance, you can hear the BBC, shortwave radio. Of course you can. First of all, it bounces off the ionosphere, so radio does pop. And so we can actually radio that far. And radio waves are very, very, very long waves. So here we've got radio, my wave, and in radio we've got television, by the way. So FM, I'll put that down. So FM, AM, okay, my waves, microwaves, and then you've got infrared, and then a very, very thin slither over here, visible light. That's visible light. Notice it's the same stuff, visible light, radio. It's the same stuff, just a different expression of it, with different expression by a different wavelength. After that, we've got UV, ultraviolet, ABC. After that, we've got X-rays. After that, we've got gamma rays, which from the nuclear stuff.
And make the Hulk.
This is all the same stuff. This is what we call the electromagnetic spectrum. So this is all the same stuff. Radio, gamma rays. So now we're talking, now we're saying, people say, well, you've made a CGI picture of, for instance, what a galaxy looks like. No. What we did was, instead of looking at this bit of it, which was the visible light, we've looked at this part of it, which is the long wavelengths. It doesn't matter to us whether we look at this part, which is visible light, or whether we look at this part, which is radio. We're looking at the same stuff. When you put the lights on and the cat knows where to go, that's because the cat can see beyond the visible light that you can't see. So the cat, to all intents and purposes, the cat looks like it's walking around in daylight because it can see beyond what you can see. It's just simply a wavelength. So in other words, when we're looking at a star that's far enough away, we're looking at, we'll use radio signals to look. That's more efficient than looking at it with visible light. So
Professor Bell.
Yeah.
On that topic, Professor Bell, they don't seem to have a problem with me using an infrared camera. Why do they have issues with using radio, which is just another version of light?
Yeah, precisely. Exactly right. So we aren't talking about some magical thing. When they can see, so when we look in with a radio telescope and we can see a star, we can see the star with the radio signals, we can also see many of these other wavelengths that are over here, including visible light. And that gives us a pretty good idea what colors are there. So we can see, we can then talk about blue shift or red shift. That's because we can actually see the colors. What are we seeing when we see colors? We are seeing wavelengths. So when you look at the visible light portion of it, we've got red, orange, yellow, green, blue, indigo, violet. These are the colors. What is a color? A color is an expression of a wavelength. One wavelength, this wavelength is red, it's a long wavelength. This wavelength is a short wavelength. How can I make green? I can combine a long wavelength, yellow, a short wavelength blue, and I will make a wavelength, and I will make the color green. So if I combine these two and they make constructive interference together, then I will make the green color. If I want to make a purple color, then I will put a red wavelength with a blue, and I will, in constructive, and create a blue color. Okay? Purple simply means the combination of the red and the blue is being reflected and all of the other wavelengths are being absorbed. Why is something black? Something is black because all the wavelengths of the visible light spectrum are being absorbed. What is left behind? Long wavelengths that cause heat. So that's why it's probably not a good idea to wear black clothes on a very, very hot day. Why is it a good idea to wear white clothes on a very hot day? That's because all of the spectrum is now reflected. So in other words, if these are reflected, none of the energy is going into the clothes and onto your body. So
Professor Bell, a good point to bring up here that I've recently looked into and I saw and I finally understood exactly why. I'd never been presented with this topic before, but it was proving that exactly what you're saying here using lasers. Okay, so they have a green balloon and a red laser will pop it, a blue laser will pop it, but the only color that will not pop it is the green. And that is because precisely what you're saying right there, it absorbs none of that energy and reflects every bit of that energy and will not pop.
That's perfectly correct. That's exactly correct. And we can use this knowledge for all sorts of benefits with respect to laser. And just while you brought up this idea of lasers, so I think people think about a laser as being a continuous beam. So let's say, for instance, we're using a laser to shine on one of the retro reflectors on the moon. By the way, which tells you that humans had some activity on the moon because there's some retro reflectors up there. They didn't get up there by magic. Okay, so now we shine a laser at these things, and these lasers are pulse lasers. So they shine short bursts of pulses, and then we measure with the wavelength that comes back. The wavelength that comes back must be from the pulse that we sent there. Not only can we tell that it's wavelength when it comes back, we can actually tell its velocity. Now, at what speed it comes back tells us what distance it is, because we know the time difference between each pulse. It's not magic. Okay, so now the same thing we can do if we want to range a satellite, we can also do the same thing with a satellite. So again, these are pulse lasers. These are not like sitting on a beach with your green laser. By the way, I'm stunned the carry away that there's a 6-watt laser. A 6-watt laser is a very, very dangerous instrument, and they seem to be flashing this around like it's a toy. So that's disturbing as it is.
Hey, Professor Bell, okay. I would like to bring something up to you just real quick. You had mentioned that you had wanted to talk to a flat earther, and we do have a flat earther that would like to come on and speak with you. He's a respectable flat earther as well. I mean, he's been on both my channel and Fight the Flat Earth. He's not about ad hom or anything like that. So if you'd like to have that conversation, we can bring him in towards the...
No problems at all.
We'll wait for you to get through the presentation first and cover anything else.
No, I'm good to go. If you got any questions on electromagnetic radiation, I'm happy to oblige.
Okay, well, before we bring him in...
I've just got one. So... One claim that I've been encountering recently is that light can be affected by electromagnetism. Can you briefly explain why electromagnetism couldn't bend light?
Light, okay. I think this is like a mix up in terminology. So when we talk about electromagnetic radiation, we are talking about light. Okay, mm-hmm. So when we talk about magnetism, this is something quite different. And the only reason that we use the word electromagnetism is because we use electricity in order to create the magnetism. So let me just rub this off and then I'll explain something very briefly. Okay, so the strange thing is that so many flat earth people come from a land where one could only describe it as the cradle of science. The amount of people who were part of the Royal Society who gave us so much comes from that little island, and yet that little island is now full of flat earthers. That's got me stunned. But anyway, let's carry on. So one of these great people, his name was Faraday. And what Faraday had, a tube, just like that, just a normal tube, you know, made of card or paper. And what Faraday did was he had a coil, just a normal coil wrapped around the tube. And he connected that coil to a device that could measure current, an ammeter. Okay, so something that could measure current. So he could tell that a current was flowing. And what he did was he took a magnet, just a normal bar magnet, north, south, and he threw this magnet down the tube. And you can imagine the people who were watching this did think this was magic, because every time he threw this magnet down the tube, he created electricity. Well, that is magnificent. So all you need to do is to find a way of keep throwing that thing down the tube, and you could light up your house. If you could find somebody, with nothing else to do except throw a magnet down the tube, that would be fine. However, you actually need a machine to be able to do that, because you want to do it consistently. Well, that's not bad. Tesla came. And Tesla worked out that, hang on a second, you know something? You don't actually have to throw the magnet down the tube. You only need it to be anywhere in the vicinity of the coil. It doesn't have to be in the tube. It only has to be close to it. Because this creates an electric field. This is an electric field. You don't need to be in the tube. So, as a result of that, thought about is, hang on a second, why don't we make this go around in circles? Because all we do is move this magnet in relation to this coil. So you create a coil in the middle, and around the edge, you put your magnets. Nice. Basically, lots of magnets. Motor. The more magnets, the better. And now what do? You turn the coil. You find a way to turn this coil. You don't have to turn the magnets. They can keep still. Find a way to turn the coil. Well, a good way would be steam. A steam turbine would do that very nicely. Well, there's a word for this machine. It's called a generator. Mm-hmm. And we still use it to make electricity to this day. That's how simple this is. From this fella over here, from that little island, Faraday.
I mean, what you've just described there is how you create all the energy on board a nuclear submarine. You use the nuclear reactor as a kettle to create superheated steam, which drives a turbine, which does what you've just said, turns the coil inside the magnets and creates electricity for the submarine to use. Same with a diesel generator. It's all the same principle, and it's such a basic thing.
Come on, it is basic. You guys are both lying here. Submarines don't exist because gravity's not real. I need you guys to please not lie anymore. I appreciate it. Thank you.
let me finish this. As a result of this knowledge, we now had to look at it and say, well, guess what? The Earth has a magnetic field. I wonder how that could be. Well, now we know that we can make a magnetic field using electricity, because the way that we could throw a magnet down and create electricity, we can use electricity to create a magnet. It works in both directions. Well, that's really handy, because in the middle of the Earth, we have core, And around the core, we have the outer core. And because this is spinning, these are moving against each other. So there's a force acting against each other. And because of this, what happens when you're moving to molten media, well, this one here is not molten, this one is, when you're moving two media across each other, you're going to create a magnetic field. That's how it happens. It's just the movement of
the
these two
against in the outer core.
Which the magnetic field. So this again is evidence that this thing here is solid. In fact, we know that it's nickel. So this is solid. This is not solid. So I've heard people say, well, how is the magnetic field created because this is heated up to X degrees temperature? That's irrelevant. The temperature of this is not a magnet. The Earth is not a magnet. Okay? If you put electricity around a piece of steel and you create, let's say, for instance, a transformer, how does a transformer work? Okay, so a transformer, there we go. There's the frame for a transformer, and you've got wires on this side and you've got wires on that side. Let's say we've got 10 volts here, 200 volts there. This is called magnetic induction. In other words, I can put a voltage across at the 10 volts, step up transformer, and I will end up with 200 volts on this side just because of the amount of coil that I'm putting around it.
The number of coils. It's a 20 to 1 ratio, right?
In this case, a 20 to 1 ratio, correct?
Yeah, in that case. In that
exactly.
Case.
All right, this is called induction. Okay, this magnetic induction. This is the same thing that's happening around the Earth and creating a magnetic field. Now, thankfully for that magnetic field, because the stuff I mentioned to you before, the electromagnetic spectrum, the sun puts all of that out. But we don't want to be hit by gamma rays from the sun, because X-rays and gamma rays will you. We use X-rays and gamma rays to sanitize things, to kill germs. If you go to the airport with a piece of wood, they'll take it off you and they'll say, we're going to irradiate this. Irradiate means we're going to put this through gamma rays. That's going to kill every living organism on it. Okay, that's the purpose of it. So we don't want those rays, gamma rays. Unfortunately, we do get UV. We do need UV because that's where vitamin D comes from. However, not too much. But certainly the stuff beyond short wavelength, beyond that, like X-rays and gamma rays, we certainly want them to come to the sun. We don't want them to affect us. But they don't. That's because, thankfully, we have the Earth's magnetic field to protect us from those things. Although the other wavelengths do come. So we get radio waves. Another way to work out the distance to the sun, that's pretty simple. We've got the wavelength, we've got the period, we can pretty much work out the distance. Mm-hmm. Right, so that should be surprising to feel. I've got no idea. Anyway, so the magnetic field looks after us. The magnetic field stops these dangerous electromagnetic waves from reaching us. Okay, so thankfully for it.
Awesome.
Wow, I think this is the okay. First time the entire panel is just shut up and listen to the person talk. Because it's amazing. I appreciate it so much. You're basically giving us a college lecture for free, and I appreciate that. Now, as you can see, we do have back down here, Sean. Sean's now on camera, so yeah, we're filling up the spot.
Hey, Sean.
Professor Bell, I do have a question for you. what would you prefer? Would you prefer to have the flat earther come on for the discussion here? Or would you prefer us set that up for a longer discussion for you?
I think we could both. It would be nice to get a bunch of flat Earth questions to answer. Okay. And it would be nice to have a flat Earther come on if he's prepared and got some questions. That would be good. Why not?
Okay. Well, I'll go ahead and get him ready. I'll send him a link right now. Earth is seriously flat. I don't know. How did it reach you? Craig, do you have his email?
Yeah, I'm pretty sure you've got it as well. I'll send you it. 2 seconds.
Okay. Well, here. I'll just email you. I'll send you the join link. Send it to him.
Yeah.
Okay, so I want to ask you a question.
globetartsociety@gmail.com.
How much quantum mechanics do you follow?
Are you asking me?
Yes, sir.
Okay, well, as much as it's possible to, given that there's so little that we still know about it. Let me
ask you this question. Are you what interpretation do you ascribe to when it comes to quantum mechanics?
Well, that's a very broad question, and because when we're talking about quantum, we're talking about the subatomic levels, so the subatomic particles. Mm-hmm. So this, let's say, for instance, an atom, hydrogen, okay, is a proton, one proton, okay? Now, hydrogen sometimes can also have neutrons, so it could have, so we've got hydrogen and we've got heavy hydrogen. That's why we have stuff called heavy water, okay? Heavy water is just simply water, H2O, made from oxygen. And heavy hydrogen, because it's got either one or two neutrons in it. Now, around that, we have electron. So, electron, we would subscribe to a negative charge. And we know this because it's the electrons moving along a piece of a conductor that gives us electricity. So electricity is a result of electrons moving from one point to another. That point we call that the potential difference. In other words, the potential from here to here. What is this potential? So this is potential difference, otherwise known as voltage. Okay, so this electron can be anywhere in here. We don't actually know where it is at any given time. In fact, the conundrum is we can't know where it is. We can't know where it's something is and predict its wavelength, or if it's I can't predict its position. And this is called Heisenberg's
uncertainty principle.
Yeah.
Okay. Now, so here we have an electron that could be anywhere in here. However, when we look at this over here and we think about putting this in terms of probability, what are the chances are it will be here, or what is the probability that it will be there? Well, it turns out it's got a higher probability of being further away. So in other words, it's 99.99% of the time it's at the extremity. This is really handy, because then that is why this electron is able to be passed on to, let's say, another two molecules. Let's say, for instance, let's say hydrogen over here and an oxygen here. So this hydrogen, because they're at the extremity, this is able to share its electron with oxygen. This oxygen, by the way, is missing. It's like it's got two holes in it for it to be comfortable. Those two holes are very handy because these two hydrogens fill up those two holes. We now have a molecule H2O. By the way, 18 grams per mole. Might be asking this question, what is a mole? Well, a mole is just simply a quantity, like a dozen. except it's a lot. 6.02 by 10 to the 23, in fact. So if I was to write this, it'll be 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 7, 8, 9, 10, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20, 21, 22, 23. That many.
You know, it's funny.
This many atoms makes one of those. This many molecules of water weighs 18 grams. So if I have this many molecules of water together, I will get 18 grams. So if you want to know how many molecules of water you got, weigh it. That's all you have to do. Wait. Weigh it. Wow. Whatever you weigh, there you go. You now know how many molecules of water. So how do I know how many molecules of gas have I got at the surface of the Earth compared to up there in space? How do I know this? Very simple. In a specific volume, I can tell how many of these I have because I know that the atmosphere is 29 grams per mole. So I can measure that and I can tell how many molecules I've got over here, how many molecules I've got at the top of Mount Everest, and how many molecules I've got at 100 kilometers away, say, or 220 kilometers away at the space station. I can tell because I can simply use this, I know exactly how many grams per mole it's going to be, and I can calculate this exactly. None of this is a surprise. Okay, any questions?
No. I'm just loving this.
I was going to point out that when I had Professor Dave Explains on, I don't know if you caught that that show or not, yeah. But He was trying to tell a joke, and I out-scienced his joke. Like, I totally missed the joke. He was trying to – I forgot exactly how he phrased it, but it was – he was trying to get the answer avocado's number, and I was like, it's Avogadro's number. And then I was like, 6.02 times 10 to the 23rd. And I was like, wait, did I get that right? And he's like, yeah, you actually did. And I was like, oh, shit. And he goes, but you missed the joke, though. I was like, yeah. Oh, okay, my bad.
just for the viewers to get a handle on how big this is. Okay? So if you go to the beach, your local beach, say it right there where you are, and picked up one grain of sand, just one, and then looked around at the beach, there would not be this many grains of sand on that beach. That is how small an atom is when you think about it. Now, look at the average size pencil made of carbon. Yes, it's got a few other little things in it. It's got a bit of hydrogen and oxygen in it, but very minor, but mostly it's carbon. So you've got a carbon pencil, you're holding it in your hand. You know, it's just like, 10 inches or so. Yeah. Well, that piece of carbon weighs about 12 grams. Well, it happens to have this many atoms in it. So if you want to know how many atoms there are in a pencil, measure it. Just measure it or weigh it. Weigh it however grams it is, divide it by this, and you will have how many atoms there are in it. Not that's a useful piece of information for anybody. Okay? Except if you're a chemist, that would be very useful. Okay. Any other questions?
So Mr. Unite for the Children says, jokes on Professor Dave, there's no such thing as avocado's number.
Yeah.
No, I think it was a drug. He meant it was meant to be Avogadro's number, which is this.
Yeah.
You've got to be thinking to yourself, how smart are these people? You know, people like Mendeleev who put the periodic table together, Avogadro who worked out this number. I mean, these are seriously, seriously smart people. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And my favourite photograph is the Solway convention where on a bench we had a photograph of 50 of the smartest people that have ever walked on this planet. You should look for that photograph.
Right, we have a super chat for $2. Detonation. I wrap my schlong with tinfoil because the government steals geniuses' loads. Make sure you wrap it tight there, Detonation. Don't want them taking your shit. And then let's see. We had some questions from our channel members. Let me run over to that page real quick and pull that up. Because we had some good questions from those guys. Whoops.
I've sent Irfus Seriously Flat a link, just waiting for him to join.
Yeah.
Hold on. Professor, could I just ask you very quickly while we're sorting that out?
Yeah, sure.
I very much love you at some point, if you're quite willing. It's something that I'm planning on doing for quite a while on my channel, was to talk about orbital mechanics, particularly related to the Apollo missions and how they actually got to the moon, because you touched on orbital mechanics. Do you think you would be happy to do something like that sometime, excellent. Well, I'll get in touch with you sometime. Maybe might be Fight the Flat Earth, or Team can drop me your email address or something, and I'll get in touch with you, and we can maybe put something out.
Nah, I'm saving him for myself. I'm saving him for myself.
I'm not sharing him. You're not allowed. He's our guest.
Using the orbit to actually increase the velocity that's in order to get there. So in other words, it's not by accident that it has to do many, many orbits. So this orbit gets bigger and bigger until it reaches a velocity enough for it to actually take off and get to the moon.
It's using gravity as a
means of energy.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, and the other things I get quite a lot as well is the biggest thing about the moon hoaxes as well is about the Valen belt. So maybe we can talk about that as well at some point as well.
Of course they did know about radiation, you know, and had to take that into account going to the moon. So this idea that they didn't take it into account is nonsense. The thing about it is that what's not understood is, for instance, this radiation, we have gamma rays, which are very fast moving and shortwave, but we also have what's called alpha and beta particles. These are the main things that's troublesome. So the alpha and beta particles. But see, these things over here couldn't even get through a piece of paper. So the fact that the spacecraft is more than enough that's needed to block these particles. So I don't know whether it's...
Well, okay. Let me ask you a couple of questions from our channel members. This one comes from Carrie Oliver. It says, other than Flat Earth, what other fringe topics do you think could be toxic to society in general?
There's two, and that is the people who say don't vaccinate your children, which is terrible. And those that think that we can keep on polluting our atmosphere and get away with it. Mm-hmm. Those are the two main things. Existential risks to all of us.
Mm-hmm. Okay, this comes from Josh Just Played You. He says, can you ask him why flurfs are willingly choosing to regress in science instead of moving forward, other than for religious purposes?
Look,
fucking idiots.
I don't know if you people have heard about this. I'm sure that most of you have. And this is Maslow's hierarchy of needs. Okay? And then these first three here deal with your security, if you like. You know, whether or not you get shelter, food, and the like. Okay? And this last one over here, this is your feel-good one. You need to feel good. And this one over here is where you are really proud of yourself, so that you can say that you are a useful human being on this earth. You get to here. Well, I think that they're striving to get up here. Now, the problem in order to get here is missing some vital stuff. And what they perceive is missing, and that is education. So they see the world zipping past, you know, with iPhones, Wi-Fi, you name it, technological changes that's happening in the world, and it's going right past them. And this is slipping away if you got there. So how are you going to get to here? You need to be able to find a niche of your own. And you guard it with everything you've got, because you're not just guarding your flat earth. You've got your own self-esteem. The minute you let go of your flat earth, you now have to deal with the fact that you don't have enough of this. So that's my view. That's my theory on that.
I almost 100% agree with you there, and I've said it in my last video. I said it slightly different. I said that flat earthers just want to really find a social corner for them to fit into. They're already as you said, so that part of being socially accepted is also being hip to technology and to the information of the time and whatnot. Flat earthers, because they're not hip to that, because they don't understand the intricacies that most of the public does, they kind of get excluded from the public in a society way. You know what I'm saying? Like people, they already kind of just push them aside just a bit. And then I think that once you get pushed aside a bit, it's much easier they get alienated. So once you get alienated a little bit, you try to find a social construct that you fit into. And that's how they find each other. That's why they find each other also being flat earthers, chemtrailists. They're just skeptards is really what they are. They're conspiratards. They just don't.
Well,
they don't
actually, it's.
I'm sorry, go ahead.
It's no different to a religion or a cult.
Exactly.
You know,
exactly.
You need to find a niche that gives you this good feeling that you've been looking for in Maslow's hierarchy of needs.
Human desire to belong to something. In other words,
here's a question from the chat, and I would like to answer it, and I would like you to rate my answer. Okay.
Yeah.
So this one comes from Alto Eager. He says, question for the professor. Like I said, I'm going to try to answer it because I'm trying to get into climate science, and I'd like you to tell me. It says, would it be fair to say that the boundary of the atmosphere and space is the point of equilibrium? So this is something that in my research, trying to learn the actual science behind climate science, I did find that there was a misunderstanding about what it means to put additional carbon dioxide into the atmosphere. It's not necessarily that the top of the atmosphere will stay in the same place. It actually increases in size. When you increase in size, what you have to realize is there is an equilibrium that we reach, a thermal equilibrium at the edge of space. That's where the energy coming in and the energy going out are as close as they're going to be. So what ends up happening is if we add carbon dioxide, we push that boundary up. Now, according to doing that, think of it like this. If you went to the bottom of a 10-foot pool and you poured another 2 feet of water on top of you, the pressure would increase at the bottom of the pool. So by increasing that height of the atmosphere, making the equilibrium part be further away from the surface of the Earth, we will actually increase the temperature at the surface of the Earth by increasing the pressure.
Yes, that makes sense. What we mustn't do, though, is confuse energy with, they're interrelated, that's energy and mass. But looking at it in terms of energy and mass, or substance, if you like. Okay, so I agree with what you've said. It's perfectly reasonable.
I'm in the process of learning that, and I wanted to test my own knowledge here.
It's quite good. Yeah.
Okay, and then I can't see. We have another question from the chat. Let's see. It says there. Here's from Peter Miss Prime for $5. It says, "Thank you, Professor Bell. Not all Aussies are flat earth Jesus." Yes, I can attest to that.
Thankfully.
Yeah.
Look at that. Fohammer 335 says, "Professor Bell is in the top three guests you've had, Team Skeptic and FTFE." It would be me, Professor Bell, and me. So.
Okay.
Yeah, I'm enjoying this more than pretty much any other show ever. It's like a brush up in my physics. It's brilliant.
0132132 says, question. There are moons in the most distant galaxies. I guess he meant to say, are there moons in the most distant galaxies where we could never possibly observe them? Is saying that there are moons in distant galaxies a valid scientific claim? That's basically what he's trying to ask.
Absolutely.
Well, yes. Why not? Because we can even stuff that can't be actually visual directly can certainly be deduced by the change in gravity or the effect of other things. In other words, let's say, for instance, you couldn't tell that the moon was, let's say the flattening of the moon was invisible but still had the mass. Some other creature from in the solar system would easily be able to deduce that there was a moon around Earth, an invisible moon around Earth. That's because of the way that behaves, because of the gravitational force of this moon that's around it.
Yeah.
So in other words, we wouldn't necessarily know what the moon looked like or its size, but we'd definitely know by the way things interact with it and the measurement of light and etc. that we know it exists, but we just don't know what it looks like.
Yeah, and you could say that about a black hole, except I think they've kind of taken a photograph of one now. Yeah. A radio, not visible light. Okay.
Yeah, you're gonna have flat earthers flipping out after that statement.
A little bit.
Let me get to the next question here. Let's see. Okay, this one comes from Brainy Beaver. First off, Professor Bell, do you know what a mankini is?
What's up, Brainy?
I hope it isn't what I think it is, but then I'm afraid it probably is.
It probably is. Okay, so here's the question. Yeah. If, and this is a capital if here, if you were to wear a mankini, what color would you choose?
I don't know. Blue, I suppose.
I was going to say he looks like a blue man.
I'm afraid with my weight you wouldn't be able to see it anyway, so it doesn't matter.
Okay, and then we have Digital Demonic Davro says, could you please ask if he knows why the Flatards think that certain science is false or fake, yet still use equations and explanations from the science they deny? Here's a good example of this. Why did Anthony Riley use George Musser as a source, but then when Fight the Flat Earth brought George Musser on for the interview, turn around and said George Musser was a fraud?
Yeah, exactly. So for some flat earthers, this is they're living. So by destroying this flat earth, we're actually destroying their living. So they need to hang on to that for different motives than the ones I was speaking about with Maslow's hierarchy of needs. So this is quite different. This is taking money off people, if you like, under false pretenses. They don't actually believe the earth is flat themselves. And we know this by the questions that they raise. And also by the excuses that they give, we know at a basic level they understand what's going on, but it's always a constant battle to try and obfuscate or find some nonsense argument that seems to make sense to someone who's not educated. But it's all about earning a quid.
Yeah.
Are we still on? Okay, good.
Yeah. Team, you there? Team's gone quiet.
I don't know if you know Professor Riley, Professor Phil, but Anthony Riley, he demonetizes his channel and doesn't actually make any money out of it. I don't know if you're aware.
Yes, that would be ego then.
We talked about this before we went live. His channel is actually monetized. He just doesn't monetize his individual videos, but that allows him to at will turn on or turn off super chats, It also allows him to put in links to other forms of revenue, like Streamlabs, which he does in all of his live streams. But Anthony's not, I can actually say 100% for sure, Anthony is not in this for funding or money. It's literally he wants to be put in the history books for something. And he can't do anything to accomplish anything productive. So he's going the Samuel Robotham route and just saying, okay, well, if history's not going to remember me for the good I've done, I'm going to have history remember me for being the idiot that I am. As long as he's in the books, he don't care.
that makes sense.
I have two more small questions, and then I'm going to ask you one that you're probably going to want to use a little bit of time to explain. So let me ask you the two layups real quick. Corsi Husky says, what is your favorite aspect of science that you're not directly involved with?
Oh, that's a very, very good question. First of all, the thing I really would love, I wish I was an artist. For science, I know very little, other than the chemistry that's involved in biology, I don't know a hell of a lot about biology. So I'd like to know more about that. But at the basic level, I know about the amino acids, proteins, and stuff like that. So I could quite easily explain how life began. Beyond that, you know, once we're talking about higher creatures, I don't know a hell of a lot about biology.
Okay, and then we have James Collins says, I would love to ask him what he believes is the next scientific breakthrough, in your opinion.
Okay. I think we'll really get to understand how matter behaves at the quantum level, and I think we'll be able to use that for energy, much better than we have so far. For instance, right now, there is a metal plate, okay? And we've got the sun, as I've explained to you before, shining and producing all these electromagnetic wavelengths. Now, if you shine a particular wavelength at a particular type of metal, it will actually cause an electron to bounce off. Now, that is a very, very useful piece of information, because that means if we can direct light at this metal, we can then create electricity from this. And in fact, this happens. It's called, this is called the photoelectric effect.
That's Einstein's Nobel Prize. The thing about it is, right now,
I think we could do a lot better than that if we understood.
Can I ask you before we get to the hard question, I'm going to ask you my own personal hard question. Do you think space-time and gravity are emergent properties from quantum mechanics?
No, I would say that they are completely interrelated, but the trouble is that we don't know enough about the intersection between them. So that's where we've got.
So do you think that because quantum mechanics is really the future of science, in my opinion. So yeah. Do you think, and what I guess I'm asking is, do you think that with a better understanding of quantum mechanics, that we'll eventually see the the gravitational constants, proof for where the gravitational constants, where the electric constants, and all that come out of?
Yeah, they won't change, but we'll get a better explanation.
Yeah, so because one thing I saw or I heard Sean Carroll talking about was that space-time, the actual fabric of space-time being an emergent property from quantum entanglement, where things that are closer together are more entangled with one another. And that's kind of like if he can show or if they can prove that space-time is an emergent property of quantum entanglement, then it would fall that gravity is affected by that, because gravity is stronger where space-time is closer together.
Well, yeah, I think that's probably true, and if you think about Einstein's postulation about gravitational waves, so in space-time there is no time, if you like, not affected by mass in one way or another. This might sound outrageous, but you know, you yourself as a body would have an effect on space-time, you know, a long, long, long way into the distance. So it would be very, very small and practically indiscernible. But every object that has mass has an effect on space-time, and there's no reason to suggest that anything that's even small, like 1.6 by 10 to the minus 34 kilograms, like an electron, wouldn't also affect space-time.
All right.
Okay, just hang in a second. One second.
Yeah. Okay, I'll get the next question ready while you take a second. Man, this is a great show, guys. This is a great show. I am absolutely loving this. Let's see. Earth is seriously flat. Hey, man, I thought you were coming in for a chat. Thanks again for your contribution to end the demonic globe zombie. You're welcome. Animal mind. I have to take my bunny for happy hour. Oh, man. Oh, hey. Good. Hey, if you got to take your bunny out, man, totally go ahead and do that. We'll be around forever. We can bring you back on, maybe on Fight the Flat Earth channel, and y'all can have a proper discussion about all this. Okay. All right. So the next question. I'm sorry.
Yeah.
Okay.
Now so go ahead.
The next, or let me go through the super chats and see if anybody has a question for you there. Okay, General E. Shady for $5. Professor Bell, please give us one easy debunk for gravity deniers we can use that they cannot refute.
Well, okay. Look, I think what I would say to the people who deny gravity, and it's this, that regardless of, even if you don't accept the explanation for like the warping of space-time, you cannot escape the fact that to us it looks like things are attracted to each other, and there are experiments like Cavendish that give you the evidence that things are attracted to each other. You can't escape from that. You can't escape from the fact that we need to have gravity for objects to be able to orbit. Okay, you can't escape from that. So whether or not you understand or want to believe in a particular idea about what gravity is, you certainly can't deny what it does. And what it does is what's important, which just leads me to this other little explanation. If you don't mind, I'll just put on the board. So this is to the flat earth people. I just want you to imagine this. Okay, so imagine that you're over here and you're shooting a cannon, and you shoot the it's going to come back to Earth. You can't deny this. So you're going to shoot the cannon, come back to Earth. Well, what happens if we shoot the missile even harder? Just come back to Earth in a different place. We might hit this continent and then this continent with our missile. But what happens if we can shoot the missile really, really hard? We'll get that missile to miss the Earth, and then it will be in orbit. That is overcoming Earth's gravity. Okay? In other words, velocity is sufficient to overcome it so that it will not come back to Earth. This phenomenon is called orbit. It's as simple as that. Get the thing to leave the Earth fast enough, it will orbit.
Orbiter Mechanics 101.
Absolutely.
Okay, so we we have one question from Bella Charge that says, Can you ask him to explain what a Higgs boson is? I've done a bit of looking into it, but it's a lot to wrap my head around.
Wow. Okay. That is a pretty hard question. And however, let's just give it a try. So let's say, for instance, we think about, and the flat earthers will probably love this because they'll probably call it something else. They'll probably call it ether. Imagine that imagine you've got all of this space around you. So we know, let's say, for instance, in the space that I'm breathing at the moment, that I've got 24.45 liters, okay, liters for each 29 grams of air that's around me. So for each 29 grams of air that's around me, that's 24.45 liters. That's a given. That's because the temperature around here is around about, this I know is an absolute fact. Okay. I've got a thought. Why did I even say that? What was your again? Just to my memory.
It was just explaining what the Higgs boson is.
Oh, yeah. Okay. 24 grams of this 24 liters that's going around. Well, if only 29 grams fits in 24 liters, there must be lots of space between the atoms, between molecules of gas. There must be lots of space in there. So you could argue, is it actually space? In other words, is there actually nothing there? What do you define as nothing? So, or is this now that's taken up by some sort of matter? So space-time isn't just space-time includes, if you like, a whole mass of things are not relevant, that we can't actually detect or easily detect, that lies in between each of these molecules. Now, the flatties might call that ether.
Mm.
Okay. So a Higgs boson particle, you could probably describe as something that fits in there.
Okay, my bad. I didn't realize I was muted.
Is that kind of what you thought about it?
The Higgs boson is something that's really hard to explain, in my opinion. I understand it from, when they start to talk about, as it being a force-carrying particle that's used during, quarks, when quarks change from one flavor to the next. And I'm not even sure if I'm saying that right, because I'm still also learning about that too. I'm not well versed on how to best explain what a Higgs boson is. A lot of people say that the Higgs boson is what gives mass to atoms, and I don't think that's exactly a proper way of explaining that.
I wouldn't mind just explaining that little bit, because that's another one of those flat fallacies about mass. What is mass? Okay, so remember we spoke about an atom of hydrogen, and we said that this was that this had a proton in it. And there are other particles called neutrons, okay, which heavy hydrogen would have, okay, neutron. Now, we know that these protons and neutrons are roughly equal in substance, the amount of substance that they have. The other thing to remember is that all protons are the same. What makes hydrogen different from oxygen? Nothing more than the number of protons. That's what differentiates them. What is the difference between nitrogen and oxygen? 7 protons or 8 protons? That's it. That is the difference. So, this proton, if you like, is the single thing that we can talk about substance. The substance of something is this proton. The more of it, the more substance. So if you've got 12 of them, then you have enough substance to make. Okay, so if you've got, six of them. If you've got 12, carbon is 12 because it's got six of those, and it's also got six neutrons.
Yeah.
Okay, that makes up 12 grams. So we can tie back the mass back to the number of protons that there are around. So we can say that this pen has a certain amount of mass in it because we can tell how many protons there are, total number of protons there are in the pen. Okay, so the total number of protons there are in the pen will tell us what the mass of this pen is. So that is probably as good a way as any of
is
looking
it,
at
is it
what
just the mass. Total number of protons or total number of protons and neutrons?
So total number of protons and neutrons, yes, quite correct.
Yeah, okay, yeah. Okay. A lot of people get a big misunderstanding when they say stuff like the atom is almost pure space. That is another misconception that I hate when I hear people. I understand why people say it because they don't understand fields, but it's not empty space inside of an atom. Go ahead. You go ahead.
It's like saying the air that you breathe is mostly empty space. Okay, all right. It's kind of saying, okay, because in any one position, how can I know whether there'll be an electron there or no electron there? Okay, we do know that the protons and neutrons are reasonably tightly packed around its nucleus. However, around that are the electrons. At energy levels, and they can be just about anywhere. However, what we do know is that what is the probability of certain electrons being in certain places? We have a pretty good idea about that. So, if you're betting person, you say that the energy level.
Another hard question I'm about to get into because this is something I'm about to do a video for Simon Dan's channel, and I'm addressing a quantum mechanics claim. Okay, the quantum mechanics claim is that the double slit experiment, the quantum eraser experiment, is evidence for God. Now, I'm not going to get in. We don't have to get in. I know, right? Please don't hurt yourself facepalming. Let me do it for you because I cut the video last night. The video was an hour and 5 minutes long. I had to listen to an hour and 5 minutes of quantum eraser, getting the quantum eraser experiment completely wrong, with colors and a fantastic Excel presentation. So I want to ask you, when I asked you about your interpretation of quantum mechanics, I guess I meant to say, are you a pilot wave, a Bohmian mechanics guy, or Copenhagen or many worlds?
God. I don't know.
Well, Copenhagen is the classic. Copenhagen is the classic interpretation. That's kind of the one that everybody falls back on. The Bohmian mechanics have pretty much been proven to be false, but you could have a hidden variable you don't know about yet that you find out later that you say, okay, well, this is the reason we have this. These interactions.
Look, the main thing about the double slit experiment. Actually, we use that a lot, okay? Because it we can predict a lot from that. Even if we didn't understand it exactly why, we most certainly can predict things from it, like diffraction, for instance. But instruments are made because of the diffraction and because of what we know about it. For instance, spectrophotometry. Okay, so prism is used to be able to diffract the light in the different wavelengths, and it's those different wavelengths that are used to actually discern what the element is. Because if I um, if I raise the, let's say, sodium to a certain energy level, and then as it drops back to its normal state, it'll give off energy, and this energy will be an orange light at certain wavelength. I'll be able to measure that wavelength, and I'm using the diffraction to be able to compare wavelength with that one, and I know, hang on, this substance is made out of sodium. So from that point of view, very, very useful tool. Then the question is, if I'm watching it, it does one thing. If I'm not watching it, it does another. You know,
my next video is going to be explaining that from the mini world's perspective.
I'll definitely be looking out for that.
Yeah, because Quantum Eraser gets it absolutely wrong. And
I suggest a really thick oven mitt.
It's going to be on Simon Dan's channel. It'll be it's not going to be that. I think I'm going to do a two-part video because he explains the experiment. He explains the process, which is what he really gets wrong. That's what I really want to point out is his misunderstanding of the of what's going on inside of the quantum eraser experiment. You know, of course, if you try to put a quantum experiment in terms of classical physics, you're going to be left with a lot of paradoxes. Philosophical paradoxes, mathematical paradoxes. That's why when people try to say, I guess in the double slit quantum eraser experiment, they're sending information backwards in time. It's been proven. Well, yeah, when we look at it from our construct and we think, you know, that everything's happening according to our common sense logic, yes, we'll fall short there. We'll have to say things go back in time, but these things aren't happening on the classical scale, on a macro scale. These are happening on the micro scale, which things at the micro level are acting completely different than things at the macro level. We don't completely have a great understanding of the complete mechanism as to why they act like that, but we have an understanding as to how to use that to make valid predictions, very, very valid predictions.
Yeah, that's the main thing. I don't actually believe they think that things go back in time. I think there's a property that's not fully understood that will actually be able to quantify that, and we can get that into a mathematical equation. I'm pretty sure we can be able to predict what that is.
Well, definitely check out the next video when I do it, because you'll see what my I've been getting much better versed in the mini worlds interpretation, and when I make this presentation, I'm going to try to do it in a way that anybody can understand without really having to ask any questions. Fight the Flat Earth, did you have something you wanted to say?
Just the chat are absolutely astounded that you're saying the quantum eraser has got something wrong. They can't quite believe it.
Yeah. No, really? Okay. Quantum Eraser has something wrong, really?
Okay, so gentlemen,
ask if Professor Philip Bell has his own channel. Yes, Professor Bell does have his own channel, and this is the link to
thank
it.
You.
Please go and subscribe to Professor Bell, because he has... he doesn't just do Flat Earth stuff there. He does do stuff for his students that he actually teaches. So there's actually some really good, you know, basic physics on there for you to go over. But he also does rip apart the Flat Earthers quite well.
Okay, thank you very much. Okay, now I hate to break up the party, but I have a lecture going to set at 3:00, so I have to prepare for it. So that includes driving to get there. Well, so I'm going to have to wind it up. But
absolutely.
Absolutely. I'm sure that I've probably misspoken now and again, but please forgive me for that. But
when you do things just on the spot, you know, I make mistakes too all the time. I think I said something dumb earlier. I said like the how many light years did it take to get to here, or something like that. I think I was reading directly from a super chat.
Yeah, like
I say dumb things too.
How many light years ago it was.
In a live stream, don't even worry about it. The information you gave was astounding.
But Professor Bell, I've thoroughly enjoyed having you on. This has been one of my favorite shows that we've ever done. I enjoy being in the company of people who really know what they're talking about. we can arrange for you and Earth is Seriously Flat to have a proper discussion on my channel. I'll speak to both of you about when we can do that, because I'd very much like to see you in debate against a flat earther. But from me and the rest of the panel, thank you very much for giving us your time.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Yeah, no worries. Okay, thank you very much, and we'll see you all again.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
And I've been
chatting. Have a nice day, Professor Bell. Bye bye.
Yeah, no worries. Okay, bye bye. I better go.
Bye.
All right. Let me.
I think that's the quietest we have ever been.
Yeah,
no, I was just
right? And I'm not complaining. That would have to be great.
You know, there's there are times when you just want to sit back and let the person who knows what he's talking about talk, because you can learn a few things.
Yeah, man.
And tonight,
I hope the chat's enjoyed that. It's a bit of a different show to normal. you know, basically, that was your introduction to physics there. A lot of very good flat Earth misconceptions explained in ways that I don't think I could have ever put as eloquently as he put them. The connection that he showed between Einstein and Newton literally blew my mind. I've never thought of it like that.
Mm. Yeah, it was amazing. Normally, you can't shut Craig up. Normally.
let me go through a couple super chats. God's Auditor says, "Hey, Professor, do you play Kerbal Space Program?"
He plays with real space program.
Yeah, I think he plays.
Yeah, he says actual satellites to the moon.
but God's Auditor, we'll try to get that question to him. Maybe when he comes on Fight the Flat Earth show. Let's see. Johnny Raggedy for $2. Fascinating show. Thank you. I love doing shows like this, guys. They might not be the dumpster fires that you all love, but you can learn something in these shows right here, guys. Like Professor Dave was on, Greater Sapien was on, Professor Bell was on. I guess we'll announce our upcoming guest. Do you want to do that right now, Fight the Flat Earth? Well, hold on. First, let's tell them what's going on tomorrow.
Yep. So tomorrow, the Shills, awesome group of debunkers that I've got their own channel, are taking over Science or Satire. They're going to be streaming their normal Saturday evening show on my channel. And so we can give them a bit of exposure. So if you want to come and check out the Shills, we're going to have, you know, obviously the panel here will be guests on the Shills, but they will be doing their show on my channel. I'm going to turn off Super Chats and give their Streamlab link. So the money goes to the Shills rather than me for that stream tomorrow. So if you want to check out the Shills, join us tomorrow at midnight UK time. That'd be awesome.
Are you still going to allow Jut the Drunk Monkey to take over the Science or Satire? You're not wise. Not wise at all.
No.
Yeah, I know, right? Jut the Drunk Monkey.
did you tell him that Simon Dan was also going to be there?
Simon Dan might not be there. I think he's doing an earlier show with the Shills before he starts taking his 2 weeks off. And then the Shills is going to come over to our channel for midnight. But Wednesday is an amazing day because we have got the godfather of debunking himself, Mick West, coming on to Science or Satire.
Yes, Mick West will be here Wednesday, my channel. It's an earlier show, 11 a.m. Central Time, so noon on for Eastern, 9 a.m. Pacific. If you're in America, it's going to be a daily show. If you're in the UK, it's going to be different for you because then you'll be able to catch it in the evening, you know, after dinner or something like that.
Yeah.
If you're
He's going to talk about his experiences dealing with flat earthers. He's going to talk about his experience with flat earthers. He's going to he wants to discuss with us the difference in the way that someone like him and people like me and team go about doing it, and how the different methods of dealing with flat earthers work in different ways. And we're going to talk about obviously his Metabunk website that he has created. And it's going to be a great show because I think any debunker has used something that Mick West has created in some way.
I actually started out with a lot of Mick West stuff because he did great stuff, but then Walter Bisden came along and just destroyed him. Mick.
Before we go move forward, though, I would like to say, Cody asked, could you post a link to the professor's channel again? It is in the description, so all you got to do is go there.
I'll put that in now. There's the professor's
channel. Now, Sean, what were you saying about Mick West?
Well, when I, you know, Mick has been around for a really long time. He actually came around about the same time I did. And I used a lot of his stuff dealing with his curvature calculator because it was really done well. And for like 2 years, I strictly used Mick West stuff. And then Walter Bislin came around and, oh my God, that dude is a brainiac. Yeah.
Walter Bislin, someone else we should try and get on.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
I've actually kind of talked to him. English is like a halfway second language to him. And he's offered to come on to shows, sort of, but he does have the English issue. He's a much better typer than he is a speaker. So maybe if we get if we can get Gio or Sly to come in and translate for him without an issue, that would be great.
Yeah, we could do that, of course.
Sorry, guys, I'm
really excited to have Mick West on.
Crazy.
Yeah, I'm really excited to have Mick West on because
Mick's still a great guy.
Everybody has used metabunk.org. Metabunk.org is, you know, the holy grail of where you go to find your answers for debunking. You know, literally any flat earth or a lot of just general conspiracy arguments, you can just type in that conspiracy and metabunk into Google and you will find the answer to how to debunk it,
since you had me big screened, I was going to prove something once and for all to everybody. So here's my hands. And I'm just going to say,
we love you.
There is no voice changer involved.
I do want to point out that when the Non Sequitur show had me on one time for the, there was a moon landing hoax guy, and he was like, look at these two pictures.
Ace.
And Ace, yeah. Yep. God damn it, my phone will not stop.
I'm debating him on Monday.
So he pulled up, it was so funny, man. Like, we were on the Non Sequitur show, and he sent out his evidence ahead of time. And he's like, and of course, Kyle shared with me everything, like the message he sent. He wanted Red's rhetoric, but he got me. And when he sent out the stuff, he was like, I don't want anybody that's not going to be prepared, that's not going to know their shit. So I took time to fucking study those photos that he sent, study all the evidence that he sent, and I found out using Mick West's Metabunk website that I found the original person who made the photos. And I found all of his personal description of why people use his photos and why they shouldn't use his photos. And I found I got the actual physical Photoshop files that he used to create the evidence that Ace was putting out. And all of it was Photoshop, the entire, everything that he put out. And Ace had no fucking clue that it was Photoshop. And he went through his whole thing and I said, did you know that this was Photoshop? And he's like, no, it's not. And I'm like, yeah, it is. I have the Photoshop files. And then loaded it up.
So
that reminds me of JM Truth.
Ace has been, yeah. So Ace, when messaging me, he said, I can't believe in capitals, italics, that you think Team Skeptic did a good job in that debate. He didn't have a clue.
Yeah, because, well, first off, I am not and have never proclaimed to be a photographic expert, like a photo analyst. Never have. I'm not JM Truth, right? So when he sent that to me, I was working from a point of ignorance, and I just did as much research as I could into the evidence that he sent me. I didn't go through and learn every aspect of photography possible, which is the point he tried to bring across, was that he was this superior knowledge person who had all this additional knowledge that I didn't have, that it was just a waste of his time. And I simply asked him one question. Did you know that this evidence was Photoshopped? And he said, no, it wasn't. And I said, yes, it was. I have the files right here. Would you like to see them? I presented the files and showed him exactly how the how the pictures were altered. The artist literally altered the picture so that he could line up certain landmarks. That's it. He skewed it. You could tell at the bottom. The
rectilinear translation, right?
And because I didn't know every fucking, because I didn't know every term, he's like, I obviously win. And I'm like, you didn't even know your evidence was Photoshopped. How do you even claim that's a win? Like, yes, maybe I'm not as knowledge on this one particular photo as you are, but that's fine. That was your evidence, and you didn't even know it was fucking Photoshopped. And I have read the guy's notes on the photo.
Could you send me the link to those notes? Because he wants to bring that photo back up.
Yeah, it's on Metabunk. Metabunk.org. You'll find it.
Yep.
I'll try to find it.
Go
ahead.
He says that if I bring up the retroreflectors, he's going to laugh in my face.
Oh,
I mean,
really?
You can laugh all you want. It doesn't change the fact that we put retroreflectors on the moon.
So what is he? Is he going to try and debunk the retroreflectors now? Is he? I'd like to see him that.
I don't know if he'll try and debunk them, but he's certainly going to laugh at me if I use them. But yeah, so that's going to be on my channel on Monday at midnight. Don't poke at me. Get your finger out of my ear.
Phrasing.
I'll stand up and look to my left, put something real in your ear, boy.
I have to separate you two.
I like this look.
Go and sit in the corner.
I like this look right now. It's cool. Sitting together. Cool. Let me check to make sure.
Brainy Beaver watching. He's like, so how do I get on the panel like that? I just send you a green screen, right? And we're like, yeah, that's how we do it now.
Yeah, I can easily bring you on with a green screen.
We're going to get some more fancy graphics to add to it so you can see it's Science or Satire. We're just experimenting more and more with what we can do with VMix. Because VMix is awesome.
This is a new program.
This has been a great show.
Yeah. Oh, I love shows that that have us just talking science. Like, it really is. It's better to just talk science than it is to talk fantasy. I mean, fantasy is great. Don't get me wrong.
To know that Prof Bell was involved in the project that put, it may not have landed the way it meant to. It spread across the moon in probably over a kilometer of wreckage, but he's it got there. And he's involved in, figuring out the next stage of where they're going to go. And I didn't realize that they want the next one to actually be a manned mission. Is it going to be a return mission? Because I know that the Chandra lander wasn't really built to then come back off of the moon. So are they planning to just send someone there to stay? Or I want to learn more about this. And knowing that we have that contact that's involved in that is amazing.
We have a $2 super chat from Space Comma Comma. I got here late, but best guest since Professor Dave. I really did like it. Professor Dave was a little bit more engaging on the conversation piece, where Professor Bell was actually here and explained so much. I mean, with Professor Dave, it was a little bit more of a speaking or just conversation between people. With Professor Bell, once he started talking, I didn't want to interrupt him. I just wanted to be quiet, listen with my ears, and pay fucking attention.
There's actually a reason for that, because Professor Dave has been trying to get into the science communication aspect of everything, and Professor Bell is a teacher, so he's looking at it from a professorship to student point of view when he came on here. So same basic grasp of everything, just different ways of communicating it.
All right. And then Chris Kelling says, great guest. Love the shows you guys have been putting out. Yeah,
we're enjoying doing it.
Yeah, I want to get away from the kindergarten talk. And that's what we're doing, guys. I hate to point it out. I hate to, be the one that says this, but when we talk flat earth science, like the science behind the flat earth versus globe earth.
Oh my God. Right.
Yeah,
phrasing.
Everybody has these oxymoronic moments in their life, and that was mine. So when you want to talk about the globe science and the flat earth science, you have to realize it's talking like kindergartners. To us, like, I can go get my fucking 19-year-old son who has no college education whatsoever. He can come in here and debunk half of the shit with Flat Earth without even being knowledge on this, without having any knowledge about the topics whatsoever. He doesn't really watch my stuff. He doesn't watch, he doesn't know my videos. I'm not taking him to work ever again until he watches.
Christ, what are you doing?
I'm not taking him to work until he watches my shows, likes, and comments, and subscribes.
I want to know what Craig was doing with his hand underneath the desk there.
Wait.
You make a good puppet, man.
Team Skeptic is Sean's meat puppet. And Casual Spaceman, thank you for coming on tonight. I really do enjoy watching your channel. I mean, that's kind of the place I've been going for rocket launches and stuff lately, is seeing what you've put out, because you're covering so much good stuff. Do you know what's coming up in regards to rocket launches and stuff?
Yeah, well, actually, SpaceX are starting to launch again. We've got on Monday the Starlink 1, which is the controversial Starlink system. They're sending those up on Monday. And they've actually got quite a few even lined up before Christmas. So this is good, you know, it's looking good. There's been a bit of a lull on SpaceX recently. Hopefully also the Starship's going to be the first prototype of the Starship 20 kilometer launch, I believe, is hopefully going to be in December as well.
Yeah, looking forward to that.
So I'm really looking forward to that. Yeah, I'm really excited. No, appreciate it. Thanks for coming on. I was totally out of the blue, and I really appreciate it. Thank you very much for having me on, team.
Feel free to casual. Yep. I'm going to ask you a question. Do you think Starlink is going to be good or bad? I'm not saying, is it going to provide a good service? Because if it works the way they predict it to work, then it's going to be a good service. But is it going to be good for humanity or bad because we're putting so many satellites in low Earth orbit?
There's two sides of the coin for that, really, isn't there? I mean, there's a lot of controversy because obviously that's going to add more satellites, more space junk and all the rest of it. I mean, they're talking thousands and thousands of things. I mean, the size of them is about, they're not particularly big. They're about the size of two big suitcases, that sort of size. Astronomers are a bit in arms about it and all the rest of it as well. So there's that aspect. In terms of the service, I don't really know. But, I mean, what they're actually aiming for is not so much providing a really great low-latency fast broadband service for everybody. But more than anything else, what they're aiming for is people in remote areas that can have access to high-speed broadband. That's what they're aiming for. And, of course, it's another income stream for SpaceX. You know, so there's lots of flips and flip, you know, different sides of the coin for this one, to be honest with you. So yeah, it could be good, maybe not good in the other aspects, who knows. You know, the low Earth orbit is getting pretty crowded, and it's going to get even more crowded. There's no doubt about that, you know. So
46,
just out of curiosity, how do they intend on launching like rockets through Starlink once it's up?
It's going to be a pain in the ass, is what it's going to be.
Yeah, it's going to be a pain in the ass. Yeah. I've been watching launches for quite a while, and you see the launch windows are getting narrower and narrower and narrower now.
I was just going to say, it's going to narrow that launch window down to minutes, you know.
Exactly. I mean, you're seeing more rocket launches that have got an instant time window. If they don't launch at a particular time, they don't launch that day or even the following week sometimes. It just depends on, you know, on the orbit. So, yeah, it's getting worse. You know, the launch windows are getting narrower and narrower and narrower and the more you see them. And that's just going to add to it. So it's going to get difficult. I mean, at some point, they're going to have to come up with a solution with the space junk. Find the satellites are one thing. But one thing I will say about the Starlink system is that these satellites are autonomous in a lot of ways. They've got their own propulsion system, so they get themselves into the right orbit. And not only that, when it comes to the end of their natural life, they actually deorbit themselves, which is a good thing. And a lot more satellites are actually doing that at the moment. But there's still a hell of a lot of stuff up there, a hell of a lot of stuff.
Yep. Oh, well, we'll figure it out. So Joseph Grant in the chat is pointing out that on the 11th of November is Mercury's transit of the sun. That's going to be something that is going to be hard for the Flat Earth to explain. I mean, I imagine it's going to be magic or something.
Okay, so let me get through these last two super chats. General Shady for $5 Aussie. Says from here, Sean's head is Skep's little head. Yeah, that's always been the case. It's not just from there, it's from everywhere and all times. Pubes and all. Yes, agree with you, General Shady.
Yeah, but now I can fist you, bitch.
Hey, chill the fuck out. Hold on.
Team, look at the smile on Team's face.
Oh, wait, hold on. Where are we at? Where are we at, Casual Spaceman? Let's do it. Chink.
Well, see, Skeptic, now when I do this...
Ah! 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 Whoa! Stop it, Sean! Ah! Oh, wrong one.
You leave me hanging.
Dink!
Bop. Yeah.
All right, guys. We're so cool. Oh, we have one more super chat from John Rapp for $2 Aussie, and he's, hold on, let me get back to it. It was a very, very, very important message, guys. It says, testing.
Everyone give John Rapp the John Rapp treatment.
Say hello to John Rapp, everybody.
Do we have to have Riley? Do we really have to have Riley? I mean, Kevin.
Hey, don't knock Kevin, the famous.
It won't let me middle finger him.
Kevin Craig,
oh, your YouTube broken again.
Look, I typed it in right.
Not Riley.
You just typed in middle finger.
No, I put my. Come on, bruh. Hold on, let me see if I can middle finger it again. Okay, I'm sorry. Go ahead, Casual Spaceman. Sometimes YouTube fucks with my head. It's not
no,
Lenny.
I was just saying, Kevin Craig's face is a good thing, not with Riley. Please don't do that again.
Look, hey, yeah. I want to show you guys. I want to show you something. I'm grabbing fact cards. Look, I'm grabbing Factard's entire string of text right there, which is all middle fingers, okay? Copy. Paste.
See.
Let's see what it does. Let's see if it puts the middle fingers. Damn it. I have no idea why it does that. I don't. Oh, my God.
Is it getting hot in here, or is it me?
I know. Team's, like, going to be burning.
It's you.
You sure about that?
Space comma. Space comma. Acknowledging all of us. November 11th and U.S. Oh, yeah. Hey, Veterans Day is coming up on November 11th, guys. Shout out to all my fellow veterans. I believe everybody on... Well, I don't know. Space comma.
Yeah, absolutely.
Space comma.
Shout out to all my fellow veterans.
Casual Spaceman, are you a veteran or no?
No, I'm not, but a lot of my family are.
Okay, well, I'm just going to boot you off. No, I'm just kidding. I'm not going to boot you off. All right, so for those of us that me, Sean, and Fight the Flat Earth, as well as AT2, Steve McRae, so many veterans out there.
There's so
many veterans out there. But to all those guys, man, I love you guys. Love my fellow veterans. Thanks for standing up and fighting for what you thought was, you know, the right thing at the time. And putting your life on the line and risking everything you had for whatever freedoms you believe in. Because when I went into the military, I went in with the premise that I completely believed in freedom of speech, and I still hold that to this day. So that's what I went in and I fought for. Not that I ever fought anybody, but that's what my goal was when I went in for the military. John Rapp with $5 Aussie. Not where I was going with that. Thanks for the love, everyone. You missed my question earlier. John Rapp, did I miss your... Oh, my God. Let me see.
Oh, we're sorry, John. We didn't mean to. We love you,
wow.
John.
Wow. I did miss it. Holy shit,
oh,
John
God.
Rapp. Why didn't you middle... You can... John, everybody in the chat, middle finger me. Not you, Sean. Yeah. Please. Please, Sean.
John Rapp's...
No middle John finger, Rapp. Sean. No! Oh! He's twisting! Look, here we go. Oh, man. John, everybody in the chat, go ahead. You can middle finger me, and I will be totally, totally fucking okay with that. Okay, so John, here's what John Rapp's question was, and I'll let Sean answer this because I think Sean has a pretty good grasp on orbital mechanics. Let me find that question again. Okay, it says... For an object in a perfect and stable orbit, free fall, is there acceleration? So I think that maybe in free fall? Is that what you're asking?
Not in a perfect orbit. They're not under an acceleration. Not if it's perfect around orbit. If you're in an elliptical orbit, yeah, I guess it would be, because when you get closer, obviously your velocity increases. That's how I read it anyway.
Even that's why they call it microgravity, not zero gravity, when you're in an orbit, is because there is still a gravitational pull. It's just you have this centripetal force pushing you out. So it balances out. You still have the forces involved there. They're just at zero.
Yeah. While you're under acceleration, like for in a rocket, for instance, as well, while you're under acceleration, you don't feel weightlessness. You don't feel... you know, the lack of gravity.
All right, and Bella Charge says, And mine too, at John Rapp. Oh my god, did I miss yours too, Bella? Shit. Where did I fucking do? Let's see. Oh, $2 New Zealand from Bella Charge. It's similar to what they call dark matter. Bella Charge, if you want to put what you were asking about being similar to dark matter, I think maybe that was when he was talking about the Higgs boson, but no, I don't think the Higgs boson is going to end up being a good candidate for dark matter. I just don't think it is. I think, if I remember right, it's a force carrying particle, so it would be like
the Higgs.
Go ahead.
Yeah, the way I understand the Higgs boson is it's more of a field that gives instructions for fermions to have mass.
It's really hard to explain that one. I can give you a couple of good videos that talk about how force-carrying particles work with subatomic particles. Because that's really what it comes down to. It comes down to an interaction between the Higgs field and the subatomic particle requires a force-carrying particle. Like, for instance, light is a force-carrying particle in the electromagnetic field. The Higgs boson is a force-carrying particle in the Higgs field, I think. I would have to, like I said, I would need to make sure about that. But I think that's an okay way of explaining that. A very basic way of explaining it, but okay. And my bad, Bella. I'm so fucking sorry. I will go ahead, everybody in the chat. Middle fingers for Team Skeptic again. And I saw your first group of middle fingers that came through. I appreciate everybody telling me to fuck off. We'll do later off camera. Or maybe Sean can do it for me right now. Go ahead, Sean. Help me
I'll
fuck off.
I'll get a super chat for you
quick.
Then.
Ah!
0132132.
Yeah! All right, there we go.
0132132 for $6.66 says acceleration is a change in direction. Objects in orbit accelerate constantly. Yes, that is a fact of physics.
Yeah, anything going in a circular, there's circular acceleration, and it's traveling at a linear speed. So, I'm trying to think
Mark,
of a good
Mark
way of explaining
Bezier
that.
Says. Mark Bezier says force-carrying particle, like a
midichlorian. Pfizer.
That's what I said.
I'm going to yell at you every time you say his name wrong. It's Mark
Bezier.
Mark
Bezier.
Mark Bezier.
Talking about Mark Bezier again?
Mark Bezier says the force-carrying particle, like the midichlorian. Yes, the midichlorian.
Yeah, exactly.
Which, according to the Star Wars retcon, came from a planet.
Craig can't help his accent.
Like,
he comes.
You like all those retcons, though, don't you, Craig?
Brown 01 says team just likes getting fingered.
That's why you like DC so much.
DC are the masters of retconning.
Yes,
but this has been a great show. I've absolutely loved this.
I had a great time too.
Yeah, and we're gonna. I'm gonna be on the Changing of the Guard for Psy Strikes.
How dare you steal my thunder, you little bitch. You stole my thunder, you prick.
Do you want to talk a bit more about that, Sean?
Well, yeah. As everybody should be aware by now, Sidestrike passed away a few months ago, and his channel has been kind of in limbo for the last couple months. And his daughters, who is in the chat right now, Sidestrikling JC Photos, has decided to take up the mantle and continue the show on.
Woohoo!
So tonight is going to be our first, it's going to be our farewell to Jeff, who was Sidestrike. And we're going to go over what the show is going to be moving forward. We're going to keep the same thing going on. Obviously, some people are having issues with Jeff's passing, so they may or may not come in the future. But we're trying to get the gang back together and keep the show going as it was as best we can, because that's the best way to remember Jeff. So tonight at 11:30 will be our first show where we actually talk about where the show is going to go, what's going to be happening with the channel, because JC wants to expand upon the channel, and we'll be covering all of that. So everybody's going to be invited to go over to Sidestrike's channel tonight. It's in about an hour and a half, and see what's going to be happening with it. You can take me off the screen.
Yeah. I will most likely be there for most of it. So
I'm staying up extra late just so I can be there. And thank you to SciStrikeling for carrying on SciStrike's channel, because he just wanted to get good science out there and have some fun doing it. So I'm looking forward to seeing where the channel goes.
I was wondering who did the duty, and I know who did it now.
What worries me is you're actually trying to sniff other people's asses.
Smell.
Smells like 3-day-old burritos.
That's what I go for.
Yes, Peter. Peter was that. Yes, Peter. SciStrike was the pug guy.
So, and one of my favorite people of all time. Now, we do have a request from the chat from Stephen Cook, I believe is the one who requested this, and it's going to require all four of our participations. So, they want to see me get fingered in each ear, and then Sean, do your thing. Here you go. Oh, wait, hold on. I got to put myself back. Hold on. Oh, that's your... There we go.
Curl a finger, bit.
My hand's disappearing.
Craig, your green screen.
There's a portal I can't get to you. There's a portal I can't get to you.
Lick the ceiling? How about no?
Guys, we have to... we have to remember there's a delay between me and Fight the Flat Earth. So if I want to give him a high five, watch this.
I'm coming.
Oh, phrasing.
Don't
now, high five, ready, casual spaceman, let's high five. Oh, you're... Now all we got to do is get him to realize the difference between right and left. Yeah, I know. It's hard. I get mixed up, too. I'm like... Because when you look right on the screen, it's looking that way.
Skeptic, do me a favor. Take your left hand, put your elbow right in front of your chest, and just raise your hand up.
My right hand?
Yeah.
Oh.
Your other hand. Yeah, put it in front of your chest so it looks like...
Yeah.
Jesus Christ.
That way... Now choke yourself.
Oh, there. I missed. We're going to have these shows for you guys all the time, man. I love doing these shows. I want to do more of these shows. I know that there's been
me too.
I get a sort of a backlash from some of the subscribers because I'm doing a lot more live shows. You guys got to understand this is now my full-time job, so this is my presence on the internet is an absolute necessary thing for me to be able to do this full time. So that includes not just live streams, but also created content. And for those people out there that don't really like the live streams, I understand. And there will always be the created content, but the live streams, I'm really, really, really enjoying this, the interaction with you guys. It makes being a channel member and channel patron, it gives you just so many more benefits. For those for the channel patrons, I posted a post on there about the questions for Professor Bill, and I didn't see any questions being asked. I'm not sure if you guys are actually seeing those posts. So if you guys will go and I think we need to have a patron meeting and see what we can do about getting you guys more involved in what I do, because the channel members, of course, they have the benefit of using the emojis, which is why we do the live streams. I mean, it's fun and all, and I know you guys are having a good time, but it also gives the channel members a way to take advantage of what they're already doing, you know, they're paying for to support the channel. And I do appreciate anything that anybody does. If you're out there and you just can't support the channel, you can't do the super chats, you can't do the channel memberships or the patron, don't feel bad, because I'm in that same position as you are. And all you got to do is you can help if you want to still support by sharing the stream on Facebook, sharing it on Twitter. Just put it somewhere out there, because that's how the algorithm works. For those of you that don't know, I've been pretty much blacklisted by YouTube, or shadow banned is what they call it. It is because I do a lot of flat earth content. It is because I'm very fucking I say fucking for no reason all the time, which is fucking fine to me. I don't give a fuck. That's what you guys love about it. You love the fact that I hold nothing back and I just say how it is, but there are repercussions to me having that persona and having that type of delivery and addressing those type of topics on the in my videos. And one of the repercussions is exactly what we saw with my last video. My last video covered a video that had 4 million views from a channel that has, you know, several million subscribers. I put a lot of work and effort into that video just to be – I took the idiot counter out because I wanted it to be universally – I'm not going to say accepted, but universally likable, you know, where someone who doesn't like the cussing – can say, well, you know, I can tolerate the few times he cussed in here. And for someone who says, I do like the cussing, would appreciate the few times that I said, hey, they're fucking morons, you're fucking stupid, you're fucking dumb, which they all fucking are. And then you, it would also be, you know, not have it so much like my normal content with the idiot dinger and all this. I just wanted a slight change just to try something else out. And I put a lot of effort into that. And it has 8,000 views. I have 21,000 subscribers. It has 8,000 views. YouTube did not push that video out, not even to my own subscribers. And that's really hard. It frustrates me to know that I put in as much work as I did and that it's not getting out to the people. I could care less about the few cents I make on the 1,000 views that I get. I want what I do to go out to the people. And it's not because it has to deal with flat earth and because it has to deal with cussing, it has to deal with mature topics and whatnot. But so that's why the live streams too, we have to do live streams and, you know, I just hope YouTube stops with this bullshit. People want to see what I have to offer. They want to see what Fight the Flat Earth has to offer. They want to see what Casual Spaceman has to offer. Give the people what they want. Quit trying to tell us what we want. Quit trying to block things that you don't think people will want. Give the people what they want and get the fuck out of the way. Your platform used to be good, yeah. YouTube. It used to be really good for all content creators. You're
went making out of your way to hard fuck for us to make a living.
I could legitimately bitch about this all fucking day because it's a legitimate bitching topic. Yeah. But
well,
thank you everybody for supporting me.
Just go with my cold moonlight test. You know, test 3 was like the culmination of all of the claims by flat earthers for the moonlight. It's still under 300 views. It was released yesterday.
And they do it. It's okay. Hey, you know what? YouTube has to do what they think is best. I think the policies they have right now are completely horrible for content creators like myself who actually do put in time. I'm not sitting in front of my phone recording myself like Daniel Pratt. I'm not doing a monologue that's 6 minutes long and clicking post and put it to the internet. My content has substance. It involves editing. That's another thing, man. At this point, I really am at the where I'm not going to say I'm desperate, but I really do need some help, guys. I need help from people that know what they're doing with editing. I need help from people that know what they're doing with the artwork, that want to contribute to the art. At this point, I'm ready to start writing contracts with people to say, look, let's go in on a joint business venture and let's grow this together. I do everything myself. Every thumbnail you see is done by myself. All the video editing is done with myself. This green screen, all this shit, putting it all up was done by myself. I'm learning every bit of this, and I can't keep up with what the demand that I have to have. The videos come out further and further apart because I keep putting in. I have to learn new and new stuff to make sure that the videos keep getting better and better. And there's people out there that have that understanding, you know, that they already have the education, they have the time. Maybe they want to work and help me out. And if there's anybody out there that wants to do that, please reach out to me and let's make something happen.
Yeah.
I know there's people out there that said that they're 3D graphics people. I could use some help with that. I could use some help with just the video. If there's people out there that want to help writing scripts, that will be able to put me in a position to put out 10 to 15 videos a month instead of 4 to 6. You know, and it's just a matter of quit being, you know, too proud to ask for help. Yeah, at this point, I'm just I have to, for the betterment of my channel moving forward, I have to put away my self-pride, my desire to not want to ask for help and say, hey, guys, look, I could use help from some of you guys if y'all have the means out there to help me out. And if it turns into some money, I'm more than willing to share in the profits, man. It's not about the money. It's all about just growing the channel. So let me read these last few super chats. We do have a few couple of members. Casual Spaceman, where are you at? You're over here. I'm looking at you, buddy. Okay? Okay? Don't fuck up!
Thanks.
Don't fuck up, Casual Spaceman!
Okay.
We're going to do it right! Or I'm going to have a fucking aneurysm! Okay, hold on. Let me replace my camera. Okay.
But he's just staring at you, dude. He's got a cold, hard stare at you.
Hold on.
Can you hear me?
Yeah,
we can hear
you. You're staring at me. Why? What's wrong with your camera?
I don't know. What's going on?
We can't have this fucking shit, man. You're weirding me out over there. Yo, guys,
you just scared. He just looked so pissed.
I'm just scared.
Do you really want to have a staring contest? I will win, Casual Spaceman. I will fucking win. I blinked. There's so much goddamn intensity in that I fucking blinked.
I win.
Please rejoin the call so we can have an actual staring competition.
Oh god.
Just refresh your browser.
I will. Hold on.
Just refresh your browser. That usually fixes the problem right there. Let me make sure my camera's still.
Hold on.
He went from that same position into. I'm going back to watch this. I swear to God.
Yeah.
He was fucking frozen there. Just frozen.
Skeptic. When you go back and watch it, when he comes back on and in motion, he looks like he's picking his nose. I swear to God.
I win. Now you made my nose itch, Sean.
He was scratching the side of his nose, but because he was looking at you, it looked like he was picking it.
All right. It's just an optical illusion, guys. We weren't picking our nose on camera, Sean wasn't sticking his finger in my butt.
Oh, man. I'm backwards. Hey,
all right,
you might be able to hit me in the head. But I can ream you out.
Ah! All right, so let's get through these last super chats and these last. Don't fuck up, all right? Casual Space. Look at you.
Skeptic. All right,
so here we go.
Skeptic.
Yeah?
Skeptic.
Yeah. What? Hold on. What?
What? Why do you think I was saying what? Does it feel hot in here earlier on? You didn't see what he was doing.
Oh, because I was looking at the super chats. I'm sorry. Okay, so let me get to the super chats. We have just out of nowhere, we've had a whole bunch of new members, and so everybody's gonna get a chance to fuck this up. All right, so here we go. Let me go to this other page real quick. And thank you, guys. I do appreciate everybody who is helping out here. Okay, so let's go to the last super chat. Mark Beiser's a new member. Yes. Look, I say his
Mark
name right.
Beiser.
You know why I say his name right? You know why I say his name right? Fight the Flat Earth? Because I fucking care. That's why.
I care. I give them their own names. I
fucking
care so much.
Care. Okay.
Mark Beiser, I give him their
he's going to come down and be at the Flat Earth Conference. Oh, by the way, guys, guess what? Flat Earth Conference is going to be on Wednesday. Mick West, we're going to have that interview on Wednesday. MC Toon will be in Dallas with me to go to the Flat Earth Conference. We will be conducting interviews with Flat Earthers. We're going to try to do it live, whether we can actually have a successful stream live out on location. That's... remains to be seen, but we will definitely try to do it live for you guys and have some kind of live show from immediately following the Mick West show. If you're a patron or a channel member, there will be a post in a few days opening up questions for Mick West that you guys might have. So let me go over here and say, Valu S. I hope I said that right. Valu S. If you want to correct me in the chat, please do. $10. Thank you very much. Do you have any plans to add to this and step away from the idiocy of Flat Earth, like more education on true science or possibly gaming?
Well, that's what we've been doing.
Hey, okay, so yes, absolutely. Great. I'm so glad you asked that question. My next video that will come out on this channel is going to be about, is going to be part two of the video that I'm putting out on Simon Dan's channel. So on Simon Dan's channel, I'm going to go over the, I'm going to cover the ins and outs of many worlds, of explaining it in terms of the double slit experiment. Then I'm going to make the second video is going to come out on my channel on the same day, and it's going to go over an example that he uses at the end of his video. So that's going to be my first step. It has really nothing to do with Flat Earth at all. I'm going to step away from that for just that video, and I'm probably going to bounce back and forth between science and fighting the Flat Earth. I'll debunk Fight the Flat Earth anytime. You guys just let me know when you're ready for me to debunk that guy, and I'll debunk the shit out of him. But I'm going
to
be jumping.
I think we need to have a debate.
I'll fucking win.
You are a
debate over who's going to be dumb fuck of the year.
Make it happen. Debate.
Let me correct Kenneth in the chat real quick.
Yeah, sure.
This is about Sly Sparkin and his false copyright strike by FE Corps, Mike Cavanaugh. Sly counterclaimed it. Mike from FE Corps didn't file a lawsuit, so YouTube had no choice but to retract it. Because Mike failed to say, no, I still think it's valid, so I'm going to sue you. Mike didn't do that because he knows it's not a valid copyright claim. So
YouTube didn't have a choice. So if someone copyright strikes you, you get the option to appeal it. And then the person that you've appealed it against has 30 days to basically take you to court or say they're going to be taking you to court. Otherwise, YouTube just have to reverse it. So, yeah.
Okay. So back to what I was saying. I'm going to probably take more advantage of my other channel. Team Skeptic VR is what it's called. We have the Science or Satire channel where all these interviews are going to be uploaded to. We're going to do the Science or Satire podcast. Several of you have asked for that. We're also going to be doing a new intro. We're going to be working with the Shills to do the new intro for the Science or Satire show. I always want to be considered an entertainment channel. I always want to be considered that.
Mm-hmm.
So it'll always be focused around an entertaining view of something, whether it's science or pseudoscience. That's the whole idea about why I wanted to be here. I wanted to be more, make anybody who watches my channel more science aware. And the way I thought I could help people be more science aware was to put it in a funny way where everybody could have a laugh too. So that's my goal, and I really intend on following through with that. God's Auditor, who was already a member, he upgraded to the Dinger Slayers. Oh, yes. Thank you, God's Auditor. You guys know what to do. Give him the dingers, give him the mankini, the meat tubes, and then the mankinis.
See, even you are starting to understand.
Shut up.
No. Yeah, you know the order, team. We're going to get it in you.
Oh, wait, hey, phrasing. You don't need to tell people our trade secrets, fight.
you want to move me over to the right a little bit, or well, to the left a little bit, actually? I don't want between you two.
Oh, you want to be between us. Is that what you said?
Oh, okay. No, thank you. Hey.
Actually.
Oh, my God. Oh, no, don't do that.
I can finger
Sean. This is too easy, guys. This is too fucking easy. VMix is fucking amazing. Hold on. Let me go
ahead. Oh, that just looks so wrong. Especially when Craig talked with his head there. That's just bizarre.
All right, there we go. All right, so let me get through the rest of these super chats. All right. Oh, let me... Wrong page. Okay, so then we have Alto Eager. Thank you for the great show. Please, more of this format, Alto Eager. I will always do this format. I love it. The conversations. That's. Are you guys fucking harassing me? Are y'all trolling me when I'm not looking at you? Oh my god! I knew I was doing something. I just hate when you twist your hands. That's when it feels weird.
Oh, wait till I do this.
Oh, this is what we do in our free time, guys. When you wonder what debunkers do in their free time, this is what we do. We find extraordinary ways of being dumb, and we do it great. Yeah, but I like having the conversation with people. The conversation with Professor Dave was great. The conversation with Greater Sapien was great. Had a great time talking with Echoplex. Professor Bell has been amazing. Fight the Flat Earth is Fight the Flat Earth is Sean's amazing. Casual Spaceman. Okay.
No.
He's got a really good hair.
Look at this. He keeps harassing me, though. See, I would say better things about him if he wasn't constantly trying to harass me. Stop fucking harassing me, goddammit.
Before we go on, I'll announce as well that I am
Skeptic. I'm here to help you, man.
In the glass.
I'm here to help, man.
Okay. So Anthony Riley has claimed that was not piss in his. He did not pee in the glass.
Right.
Bollocks. Look at me, totally peed in the glass live on stream.
Is it? Everybody's called him Leaky Warrior now, isn't it, or something? Leaky Warrior.
Yeah.
Leaky Warrior.
All right. So we have Carrie Oliver. Let's see, Carrie Oliver. Oh, I'm sorry. Valulu or Vaolu S. God, man, you're gonna have to tell me how to say that. I hate pronouncing shit wrong, and I do it all the time. So if you'll just please throw a pronunciation in the chat. Thank you very much.
Seeping warrior.
he became a new member, so you know what we do for the new members, guys, right? Everybody, what do we do first there, casual spaceman? What's first?
What? Come again?
Will do.
Phrasing.
Will do, but what comes first when introducing a new member, casual spaceman?
Oh, my coffee.
What?
He doesn't know. He doesn't know.
You don't fucking know? Do you not watch my goddamn live shows? Are you fucking kidding me?
Yeah, you better hide.
The goddamn dinger comes first there. And then what's after the dinger, spaceman? The meat team or the mankini? No, that was before the dinger. What comes after the dinger? The what?
The mankini, isn't it? The meat team.
Goddamn idiot. Ding! It's the mankini. Wait, the meat tube. God damn it. Did you say mankini, right? You didn't say meat tube.
Welcome to Science or Satire.
You guys have fucking confused me to the point that I don't even get my own goddamn order right. I'm the fucking idiot, okay?
We're just proving a point that the Mandela effect is real.
And then Carrie Oliver says, for $33.33. Thank you so much, Carrie Oliver. I appreciate it. YouTube won't let me send what I want, so F the effing Fs. Carrie, yes, you can send whatever you want, bud. Send it to me on Discord or somewhere else, and I'll make sure it gets read.
That's creepy as hell. You're actually staring through Fight the Flat Earth's ear to read your screen, man. That's just disturbing.
That's where all super chats, guys. Here. Listen, all super chats are routed through. Listen, there is a reason for this, okay? We route all super chats through Fight the Flat Earth's head because there's nothing in there to stop the signal. I get the most signal when routing the fucking super chats through his head.
See?
It's empty. Okay, hold on 1 second. Let me get back to the super chats page because we have a few more new members too. I'm sorry, Carrie Oliver. If you fucking want it, a moderator will approve it if you put it as a regular chat. Tag FTFE because right now I'm not looking at the chat. NANA for $6.66. He says, great show. Satan approves. Hell, Satan.
So he pokes him in the side of the head.
The what? I can't even see what I'm doing.
Dude, this is disturbing. You keep scooting closer and closer to Craig, man. It's getting really
hold on.
Unsettling.
I love that guy.
I'm more concerned what he's doing with his hand down my crotch. God.
Oh, I'm moving you. Oh, hey. Oh, yeah. Look at this. Hold on. We got to get this right. Baby Craig, go sit in Daddy Skeptic's lap.
Bounce me on the knee, Daddy.
Oh, no. Okay, I'm done.
Baby Craig, listen, Baby Craig, will you please calm down for just a moment? Calm down, Baby Craig. I'll get you some breast milk afterwards, okay? Hold on, stop moving. It makes us look like we're uneven. Hold on, I'll just make you smaller so you can't, even when you move, you don't get out of my... There you go. All right, so...
Da-da!
Len...
All right, baby penis head. Yes, I do have a baby that does have a penis on his head.
Okay, here's the assignment for all you people who love to grab memes out of it. Craig was just lap dancing on Team Skeptic. Go.
Oh, hold on. Y'all want to meme something? Y'all want something to meme? Give me 1 second. I'll give you something to meme. Oh, there we go. God. Now let's get all zoomed. Oh, that's too far. That's too close. Hi.
Bitty.
I wish I could put my arms in front of you, but unfortunately, two dimensions don't work like that. Lean back, Craig! God, no! Nope. You're not going back far enough!
Oh my God. Baby Craig.
This shit is too dumb, y'all. Oh, why do we have so much fun? Okay, Gravity Axe. New member. Oh, wait. He upgraded Gravity Axe upgrade. I think we already did this, but just in case we didn't, let me give you something, Gravity Axe. This is from me.
Hey, Skeptic.
To you.
Can you put him, like, right here?
Let me see. You got to tell. I can't even see what you're talking about. Hold on. Where?
Right about here.
He is right about there.
Where his hand
is. On my screen. Where on? Can you put it
on his hand?
I thought you meant.
No, leave his ass that small. Put him right there on my screen if you can.
Yo,
nope, it won't work.
Yeah, it will.
No, I don't.
Hold on. Y'all don't trust me or something? Oh, wait. Maybe it might work. This might mess everything up. I'm not even kidding. No, it does. It
works. Hey!
Put him down. Put him down.
Now lift him up.
Put you up.
Drop him.
Put him back.
Hey, give back my baby. Give back my baby. That man ran off with my baby from Walmart.
Oh my God.
All right.
Oh my God.
Sorry, when I do my extra loud, extra raspy country voice, I sometimes have to cough. All right. B-Truth, new fucking member. B-Truth, what's good? Thank you very much for becoming a new member. You know how we do it. Casual Spaceman, you get one more chance to come back on my goddamn show. What do we do
now,
first there?
Now,
sir?
Here's the thing.
I'm sorry.
What was the question?
What's first for the new members?
What's first? Oh, no, Dinger.
Yes!
Yay! Yes.
And then comes the...
Mankini.
You son of a bitch!
Yeah, good man. You can come back anytime, like casual.
I would just like to point out that while Neil deGrasse Tyson drops mics, I drop Craig's.
You drop Craig's, yes, very much so.
Gravity proven, right. Dropping Craig.
Gravity.
Wait,
drop the Craig.
I said my name in the American way.
Oh, B-Truth says, for $2, debate FTFE over who should win Dumb Fuck of the Year. That debate is coming, guys. That debate's coming. Yeah. We'll set that up when we get closer to nomination. We'll do the nomination, and then we'll debate, and then you can vote based on our debate. I will win.
I'll just shake the glass.
Your lap now. Oh God, Jesus! No,
he's got
pride in your lap now. You got baby Pratt in your lap now.
you got a Pratt in your lap.
Oh no! Don't Pratt. Put Pratt in my lap. Is Pratt really Pratt, in my Pratt, fucking lap? Pratt. Stop that! Oh Pratt, look at you, you little dumb shit. Hold on. Let me get myself.
This is a baby that got dropped on his head.
Well, that's too close. Hold on. I'm sorry, Pratt. I'm sorry I dropped you on your head as a baby. I'm sorry that mommy fed you lead and spray can and spray paint bottles and all that good stuff. I'm so sorry. If you would have never been eating the lead, you wouldn't have turned out as dumb as you are. Fucking moron. Bring my baby back!
I want my baby back, baby back, baby back.
No, that not that guy.
Not Riley.
Or that guy. No, don't, not Gigantor. Please, Gigantor. Alright. I think we have one more super chat. We're going to call it a night, guys. Oh, yeah, this is a great super chat, too. He corrected me. For $2, he says, Volus. Volus. I hope I said it right. And you didn't have to super chat that in there. Volus. You could have tagged me in the chat, man. But I appreciate it. Thank you very much. I had a great time tonight, guys. He says, but Google hates having just one name. And, yeah, that sucks. Google's shitty. Okay, so thank you guys, everybody, for coming out tonight. I do appreciate you hanging out. Big ups, big thank you to Professor Phil Bell. Go check out his channel.
That was awesome.
That was an amazing discussion. In fact, this last hour of comedy was totally unnecessary. This was all extra. The real show came when he was talking. Because that man fucking had a great conversation piece with us. Yep. I learned a lot just listening to him. I hope you guys in the chat learned a lot. Let's go ahead and walk it out. I'll go ahead and first kick it over to Casual Spaceman. You can walk us out first.
Walk us out.
Tell people about your channel. Oh, you just don't watch my channel. Hold on. Where's the mute? Where's the kick button? No, plug your channel, tell people what you do, and what's coming up on your channel.
Well, I'm the Casual Spaceman, as you all know. I'm on Monday. Come and see launch of SpaceX Starlink 1. Come and watch for that. And you know what I do on my channel. But I just want to say, team, thank you very, very much for having me on the channel. Really appreciate it. I've had a lot of fun, and it's been a big education as well. Thanks a lot.
Yeah, this was fun, man. I always have a good time. Let me get Craig back up in here so he can be respectable as much as that's possible looking like that. Jesus Christ, how big did I make you? That's really not my fault.
Raising.
Yeah.
Beefcake.
Whoopsie. Let's go ahead and make sure that you're the right size, Craig. Hold on, because, you know, this is more real to life right here. And no, it's not perspective. He's not sitting behind me. He's actually sitting about 3 feet in front of me. So, yeah, I definitely recommend checking out the Casual Spaceman. He's a great channel to watch. I catch his stuff. I don't know if I've ever caught you live. Do you go live?
Most of the launches, but I'm hoping to do some live streams some point. Different ones. I've experimented with a few, but they've not gone really well. So, but I'll figure it out.
Well, that's awesome. Hey, thanks for just stopping by. And anytime we're talking on a subject like to get in and offer knowledge on, or offer your perspective on, even just please. Message us. And we like to give opportunities to other channels as well. I think it really helps the community. I think it really helps the community to build up something that's well defined. That's something that we can say we can pull from each other. We can have knowledge base beyond what me and Fight the Flat Earth are experienced with or experiencing. So we can always turn to somebody else like you or Professor Phil Bell or Wolfie 6020, Greater Sapien, Professor Dave, Simon Dan, Conspiracy. I mean, there's so many of us. We got to keep that, maintain that unity. And I think that comes with bringing channels onto to our channel as well. So thank you very much for coming on and offering.
Thank you.
All right, hold on. Yeah, no problem. one second. I think Sean's messaging me on the side.
Yes, I am.
Oh, yes. Okay, we gotta show this, guys. Okay, I'm showing this. Hold on, I'm fucking showing it, man. Hold on, let me zoom out a little bit.
Fuck it, do it live.
Do it fucking live, guys. Okay, hold on. Here we go. Here we go. We're close. We're close. Okay, let me go find that. There you go, guys. FTFE proves gravity is real. This is beautiful. In fact, yeah, let me go ahead and add that. I'll add that to the next one. All right. Anyway, so yeah, check out Casual Spaceman, and I guess we'll kick it over to you, Sean.
Well, like I said, my most recent, I don't know if you want to call them debunks or just exposing the stupidity yet again, has been dealing with what going over this whole cool moonlight claim that has resurfaced because of Anthony Lilley. So I did a 3-part series on that explaining why he's a dumbass. Without so many words, just doing the actual observation that he's not willing to do. And lately I've been getting into gaming just because there's not really anything new from Flat Earth, so I don't deal with religious topics, so I don't go towards the young earth creationists. I don't deal with politics because that's just toxic anywhere on YouTube, because you're never right on that. So I just
there's
been
no
like
way, streaming. There's no way you can be right in politics. You're gonna piss off. You're gonna piss off 50% of the people with anything you say. So that's why I don't talk politics. It's like there's no right answer. Everybody has a different right answer. So.
So I've been doing a lot of streaming lately with Red Dead Redemption 2. I might be trying to convince these two dumbasses up here to, you know, go online with it. Oh, no, no, no. You're up there, too. You know, watch out. Watch it.
Ah! You have to warn me, Sean. You can't just be doing what the doctor does to me without telling me. At least he tells me, you know, hey, it's going to be uncomfortable here.
Where's the fun in that?
Buy him dinner first.
Yeah, right.
No. But that's pretty much what I'm doing. You know, if something comes up, I'll debunk it. But I'm not seeing anything coming new out of the Flat Earth. So it'll be primarily gaming at this point.
Is he moving?
Doesn't happen. New things.
Is he moving?
Yeah, he's moving. You might want to be afraid. He looks big enough to eat your head, man.
Man, hold on. You obviously don't know who I am. Let me fix that problem real quick. There you go. No problem. Problem solved.
Oh, now I look tiny again. Thanks.
You want some, Cash Spaceman?
Oh, my God.
Oh, yes. All right. So, so I guess Moonlight video coming out for you again, Sean. Another one.
No, I've got one more I can do where I actually do the experiment longer. But the point has been proven that moonlight does not cool things off.
It does not cool things off. You're right.
Because that's not how light works.
But I do plan on doing it one more time for a longer period of time per device I'm using to magnify the moonlight. Just to rule that out as an option.
All right. Excuse me. Fight the flat earth. On you, bud.
Well, tomorrow, obviously, on my channel is The Shill's Takeover of Science or Satire. And then Sunday, I'm going to be spending the day playing video games with my wife because I need to qualify for the next season of Overwatch. I've got a new video that I am working on, which is this one. That will be out in the next few days. And then on Monday, I will be debating a dumbass about moon landing stuff on my channel. Oh, also, I have a collaboration with Professor Stick coming up.
Oh, yeah,
and he will be
a
future guest on the show also.
That's right. We do have him coming on. What's that? A collaboration with you and him, and then a future appearance on Science or Satire. A lot of people have asked for Professor Stick to be on, so I'm glad. And yes, I did miss one huge, huge person that helped us out, was very scientific when he was here, and that was Martimer. I just didn't say anything. But yeah, Martimer's a big influencer in our community. So anybody who's in the community who does debunking, a lot of viewers don't see him because he's just recently come back into the scene. And the way the YouTube algorithm works is if you don't consistently post, then you can kind of get lost in the algorithm. He took a significant break to deal with family stuff and whatnot, to deal with real life.
He had babies.
Yeah, and he just didn't have time to post. I mean, I can understand that. And so a lot of the newer viewers to this arena, they're not very familiar with him. So I think it was a good opportunity to kind of expose him to some of our viewers. And he was really a good guest too. Yeah, I really enjoyed his time.
Yeah, me too.
And Professor Stick, that's going to be amazing. And I've also, I really hope this guy responds to me. I've reached out to Donut Operator. I want to bring him on. I hate you, Sean.
Search it up, Sean.
You know who I'm talking about. He's the guy with the, like, the thick mustache. He's a cop. He does, like, cop videos, like Sovereign Citizen videos where they're like, I'm a traveler. And then he just, like, gives commentary over the Sovereign Citizen videos. It's great. You should check him out. It's called Donut Operator. I've reached out to him to see if he'd like to come on, and haven't heard anything back from him, but hopefully he'll reach out back out to me. All right, so I guess this is going to be where we end the show. Let me switch over. I'm going to ask you guys, nobody on the panel, I don't want anybody on the panel to answer, but I just want to ask the people in the chat and see who the first person is that recognizes this. But whose house am I in?
I know.
I got to go look at the chat, though. I want to see who answers it right first. Whose house am I in, guys? Let's see. We're watching the
chat. Does he know?
Chat's going fast. Really fast.
Oh, wait. I have it on top chat. Shit. Let me go to live
chat. I haven't seen an answer for it yet. Oh,
there's there it is. BJ. BJ.
You're BJ. Right.
So everybody, take your screenshot now. And then what I want you to do is I want you to go on to Twitter and I want you to tag Simon Dan with this screenshot with the quote, Team Skeptic is in your house. He will be watching you while you sleep to make sure you are safe. And then put, he loves you very much. That should kisses. Keep him awake for a few days. Yeah, kisses. Three heart emojis. Hashtag Halloween every day.
No, hashtag creepy stare.
Hashtag. Give him this one. Ah,
someone screenshot that. that's not terrifying.
No, I've got one when you actually look really angry.
That is the end of your bit.
No, it's better than that. You have the mouth open.
But anyway, so, all right, guys, that is where we're going to end it tonight. Be on the lookout. Well, I guess we'll be seeing you guys tomorrow on Fight the Flat Earth channel. We'll also be seeing you possibly on Sunday here when we kind of do an update for the FEIC adventure. I'm going to try to get Arn Ra on there for that because I have been in talking with him about getting him to the conference and participating with us. We'll also have MC Toon, who will be, I think he's going to be live from... he's going to be live from Galveston. That's before he makes it to Dallas. And then once he gets up here, we'll do a show from up here, I'm sure, live. So other than that, I guess Fight the Flat Earth or Sleeping Warrior. Oh, my God. Sleeping Warrior. What are you doing, man? Get the fuck out of here.
Well, we can't see him.
Oh, yeah, I guess you can't.
Dumbass.
Oh, I'm so dumb. Okay. So thank you everybody again, and y'all have a great evening. You know what we're all here for, right?
Time for the fail whale.
It's not a fail whale if I succeed, okay? But I have made a promise. Well, I have made a promise to somebody, because every time I ran into Quit Fucking Asking Me to change my name, I asked him to change his fucking name, and he said he would do it if I changed my outro. And I was like, okay, fine, let's do it. So he changed his name to Quit Asking Me to Change My Fucking Name, Team Skeptic. And so I get to change my outro today just for him. So I'm Team Skeptic, and I fail. I told you I'd change my outro for you. You ain't shit, boy. Now I got to make sure I end it properly so I don't fail at this point.